Okay, welcome, welcome, welcome. It's so good to see so many of you here. This is our first Parkinson's Disease Symposium. I'm Pauline Hill, and it's the first one to be held here in Kingsford by the Parkinson's Society Support Group, our local group. We hope you had a nice, colorful ride here. It's a beautiful day, and it's been interesting planning this program. Someday I'll tell you the story of how it began. But thank you, Don, for playing the piano for us. We appreciate that. We're sorry we're late. I was going to try to keep to the minute, and it isn't going to work. We have a few housekeeping chores just to cover to remind you about what's going on. You each received a ticket as you registered. Keep that ticket all day because it makes you eligible for a prize, and we have a lot of prizes to give away. So listen for your number during break time, and we'll call somebody. If you aren't present when we call the numbers, well, we'll try to get you around, we'll try to get your attention somehow. Otherwise, we'll call another number. If you had some food issues, I think we have some gluten-free food left and vegetarian food. If you need some, talk to the people in the kitchen. They're going to handle that for you. And try to be on time for each speaker. As I said, I was going to try to keep the program within the time schedule. However, Jo has so much to offer, we might not get her out of here. I might not even let her go home. Bathrooms are located right here in the hall, outside the stage door, and also down that long hall toward where the vendors are. I call them the vendors, the health agencies who are willing to talk to you and give you some freebies. They're way down the hall in the what they call the fireside room. And we hope you have a chance to visit them sometime today. They will be here all day. They aren't going to be taking down until after 3 o'clock as well. Let's see, what else is I gonna tell you? We hope that each presenter will have time at the end of each speech to give you some questioning time. If you have a question, write it down and ask them after they're done talking, or maybe even later on in the day, or maybe if you have to write it down and you really want an answer, put the name of the person you want to ask that question to, and I will give it to that person, and hopefully they'll talk to you about it. Our bookstore in the Midtown Mall has my Bible. If you like a book to read about Parkinson's disease, right here, Parkinson's for Dummies. And I know that our Midtown Mall has a few copies if you're interested. Somebody's going to win one today, too. And Joe has a lot of handouts. There's just a ton of handouts about Parkinson's disease out here. Here in the hallway and down at the end of the hall where the vendors are. Please take that stuff. We don't want to take it home and have to just, you know, put it in boxes. So take it home with you. If we run out, well, that's the way it goes, you know, how that is. And now let's introduce Jo, our first speaker. You may already know that she's from a small town in Texas near Lubbock in what she calls the miserably flat plain, flat panhandle of Texas. She'll enjoy our hills and colored trees. In fact, she's anxious to have a ride around. She has a BS degree in counseling and a master's degree in nutrition. She worked for many years for the American Parkinson Disease Association, which is called APDA. Get the rest of my notes. I didn't plan to be walking back and forth. And she has been the information and referral coordinator in the Lubbock office for APDA. For the last 2 years, she has been the director of the Southwest Parkinson Society, covering a large portion of Texas and New Mexico, and that's how I met her. She came to Las Cruces, where we spent the winters. She's also, she came and talked to us at our support group there. She has taught nutrition, and she still is teaching, and she has been a neurology educator for the Covenant Health System, even while doing the APDA job. And she's still an educator, as I understand it. She taught the day before she came here, whichever was yesterday, and hardly realized that it was time for her to fly here We picked her up at 10 o'clock last night at the airport right out here. She puts on a good pamphlet.
Is that one here?
She has some samples for you, and you're welcome to order them and get them mailed to you, and even at no cost. I sent some money, but she said I didn't need to, but they need money just like everybody else does. You can't do this for free. And there's wonderful articles in here that you may be interested in reading. There are some sample copies out in the lobby.
What else?
Joe and the support group that I attended in Las Cruces were my inspiration. And this is what got me to be a support group leader here in Iron Mountain, Kingsford. And I'm so glad to have this symposium. Joe, will you just come on up and do your thing?
I'll try. In my eyes all the time. Is that better?
Yeah.
Well, first, let me thank you all for allowing me the privilege of coming to the Upper Peninsula. I've been to Michigan before, but never to this part of Michigan. And what I've seen so far is beautiful, although I had my son-in-law called me this morning and he wanted to know where I was and if I was seeing pretty trees, and I said, well, so far all I see are pines, so they're not colored, but we have seen a few this morning as we drove over here, so I am excited about seeing. We don't have very many trees in Lubbock. We have some that have been there for hundreds of years, no joke, and they're still only about this tall because we're on the edge of the desert, so nothing grows very quickly there. I want to, before Pauline leaves, I want to publicly acknowledge her and get you all to publicly acknowledge. It takes a multitude of people to do this, but she has literally worked herself to death for the last several months, and she needs to be acknowledged for her hard work. When she first asked me if I would come, I said, well, sure, if you'll pay my way. I can't afford to, you know, go up there on my own. And so she said, okay, and then all of a sudden she got the idea about doing a symposium, and it just kind of blew up from there. Look around, it's a great crowd, and I'm very thankful again to be here. And I'm like you, I'm going to have my little notes over here so I don't forget anything. She mentioned the Tulip Messenger, which is my newsletter. We do it quarterly. We used to do it once a month, and it just became way too expensive, so we do it quarterly now. If you would like to be on our newsletter list, mailing list, or if you'd like to receive other things from us that we do periodically, I have a little pamphlet out there that looks like this, and if you will fill that out and either give it back to me today or mail it to me, you can tear that off and mail it to me, I'll get you on our mailing list. And like she said, it doesn't cost you anything. We always accept donations, but we don't require them, so if you're interested in that. And I brought about 50 copies of a little poem. It's called The Parkinson's Poem, and I purposely did this. This is a lady from my Amarillo support group, but she's from Michigan. And so she created this poem. She's a very creative writer, and she created it, and I really like the poem, and so I copied it and brought it for you all today. I hope you will enjoy that. There are a number of handouts out there. I didn't bring enough for everyone, but if you want a handout that you like on cognition, and I will tell you, I'm not a fancy writer, and nothing that our group does is fancy. We're very plain Jane, and that's for a reason. We don't have a lot of money. So we do it on the cheap, as I say, but it's informative. And I will, true confession or whatever, that newsletter is, unless it's otherwise noted, every article in there is by me, and I try to correct all of the grammar and all of the misspelled words, but it never fails that there's always, everything I do, there's always mishaps in it, so I will apologize ahead of that. I also tell you, I don't look like I have a master's in nutrition, and that's because I don't, and that's probably I probably misinformed her. My master's is actually in health education. I do teach nutrition, and I don't look like that either. I have an excuse, or a small excuse. I'm old, I'm middle-aged, you're going to see me fanning, I'm to that point. in life. In a moment, I had a little hot flash over there a while ago and started failing. And I've been incapacitated for several months with a knee injury, and so I couldn't exercise. And so I have I've never been skinny. Well, not in years have I been skinny, but I've had this extra little spare tire that I've collected over the last several months because I couldn't really do anything. So that's an excuse. I also worked very hard to put together a PowerPoint presentation that I was going to show you. And the first picture I had up there was my brand new one month old first grandson. And I left the PowerPoint at your house. So so all of my hard work was for nothing. Okay, I apologize for all of my mishaps, and I'm going to go ahead and do that right now. And let's get started on what I really came to talk about, and that's Parkinson's. The first thing I want you to do is look around the room. Do you see anyone that looks like you do? You may see some similarities. There are some of you that have same color hair. There are some of you that maybe are kind of shaped alike. But do you see anyone that looks like you do? Well, guess what? And I want you to remember this henceforth and forevermore. Just like there is no one in this room like you, there are no two Parkinson's patients alike. And the way that the disease affects you is different than it affects everyone else. And that's one of the most frustrating things that I hear from professionals, from the physicians that treat you, is that there's no cookie-cutter way to do it, because every single one of you is different, and the disease affects you differently. The medications that you take affect you differently. The side effects that those medications have affect people differently. Here's another strange thing about it. A doctor can put you on a medication, let's just pull one out of thin air and say Azelect, for instance. And you can have horrible side effects. And you can say, oh, I can't use that. Or maybe it just you don't even do well on it. 2 years later, they can try you on that same medication, and you will respond very well to it. So keep that in mind as we talk about, not only today, but every time. Keep that in mind, that there are no two Parkinson's patients alike, and the medications are going to work differently on every one of you. The side effects are going to be different. So always keep that in mind when you think about Parkinson's disease. Someone has already sent me a question, and one of the references in there was, well, why did a doctor do so-and-so? Well, I'll tell you that one of my medical directors in Lubbock, a person that specializes in Parkinson's, several years ago, he said, you know, I feel like I'm playing Russian roulette when I'm treating my Parkinson's patients, because I'll do things and do things that works well with one patient, has no effect on the other patient, or doesn't work well. He said, I'll get everything smoothed out and everything's going great, and then they'll come down with a cold or hay fever, and it just sends the disease spiraling out of control. So again, keep that in mind. Doctors are doing the very best they can with what they have at the time, and it changes often, and you all change often. And that's another thing I want you to remember. Everything affects your Parkinson's, and that sounds kind of crazy, but it does. One of your biggest problems, or one of your biggest enemies, is this little thing called stress. Any of you ever feel stressed? We all do, and here's the problem with stress. Your body cannot differentiate good stress from bad stress. And what in the world do I mean by that? Well, good stress is like when you're planning a birthday party, or maybe someone's planning the birthday party for you, and you're going to go to a birthday party, and so you're all excited. But guess what? Your body interprets that as stress, even though it's a good thing. And your body can't differentiate that good thing from that horrible stress like Pauline, bless her heart, has been feeling for the last several weeks in preparation for this.
It's been a challenge.
It has. Last night I felt so sorry for her when she picked me up at the airport. She looked exhausted. She looks, I don't mean that in a rude way, but she looks a lot better today. We probably both do. I hadn't had any sleep. I hadn't even been to bed in 36 hours when I arrived here last night. So we both looked kind of bedraggled. But again, your body cannot differentiate good stress from bad stress, and stress is a killer for your Parkinson's. You can tell. I don't know if y'all noticed. I'm gonna point it out so you will now. I've never seen this woman tremor. I will admit I hadn't been around her very much, but I've never seen her even have a tremor. And she was tremoring quite rapidly a while ago when she was standing up here. So stress is a killer for you. And I didn't even plan on saying any of that to you.
Is there a minimum age?
A minimum age, no. Matter of fact, the youngest person ever diagnosed that we're aware of with Parkinson's was a little lady from Oklahoma, and she was 4 years old. They call that juvenile Parkinson's disease, and it's sort of a different demon than the kind of Parkinson's you have. You can also be, oh, there's no limit to it, but I will tell you, we talk about Parkinson's being an old age disease, but oddly enough, those people who live the very longest, people who are 100, 105, 110, they rarely ever have Parkinson's disease. So it's kind of an odd thing that we refer to it as an old person's disease, and yet the oldest among us don't develop Parkinson's disease.
There's no hereditary connection either.
There is a hereditary connection. They have identified 39, to this point, at least I think this is still correct, 39 genes that are involved in the development of Parkinson's. So we know that there is a, let me rephrase that. We know that there is a genetic component to it. About 10% of the people that have Parkinson's, there is definitely an inherited factor where you can say, okay, grandmother had it, my aunt had it, and great uncle so-and-so had it. So there's definitely a genetic component to it in some families, but that's only about 10% of the cases. The rest of you are the lucky ones, I guess, that we don't know why you developed it. Pauline said last night she thought hers was from the pesticides and herbicides that she grew up around when she was on the farm. And that makes a lot of sense, except she had three siblings, and she's the only one that developed Parkinson's. And they all grew up being exposed to the same things. And that's the tricky part that people who are doing the research don't really understand. But I will tell you that it's probably like every other chronic disease, cancer, heart disease, all of those things, there's a genetic component to all of those, but there's an environmental trigger that does it. Now, why again do one sibling get it and no one else does when you've been exposed to the same things? That's the mystery that we still have not been able to solve. We do know that there seems to be things in the environment that increase the likelihood of you developing Parkinson's. For instance, pesticides and herbicides. They did a huge big study several years ago in the Midwest, where we use a lot of pesticides and herbicides in the Midwest with all the corn and other production they have there. And the only thing that they could determine from that study was that people who smoke are less likely to get Parkinson's. They couldn't directly associate any of the pesticides and herbicides. Now there was a doctor after that, a researcher in, I believe she was from Switzerland, I may be wrong about her location, but she said, you know, the problem is though when we look at these studies, we individualize those herbicides and pesticides. We look, for instance, at DDT. And, okay, maybe DDT itself doesn't cause it. And she said, but that's not the way farmers use products. They use them in combination. So maybe it's a combination. We also know, for instance, that welders are more likely to develop Parkinson's, and they believe it's because of the manganese in it that they use when they use the little rods. We know that people who were exposed to Agent Orange, which, again, is a pesticide or a herbicide, during the war were much more likely. And that's why, by the way, if you're a veteran and you were in Vietnam or you were in Korea where they used a lot of Agent Orange, then you get extra benefits. They, even though we can't say that it causes Parkinson's, the government actually will acknowledge that it increased your chances of developing Parkinson's. And as I understand it, the only rule is that you had to be boots on the ground where you might, even if you were not directly exposed, if they were using that product and you were boots on the ground, as they say, then you have extra benefits. So be sure that you contact the VA. Before we stray any further, let me get back to my notes, and we will we'll come back to some of these questions if you don't mind, because there are some things that I definitely want to cover. Dr. James Parkinson's, by the way, was the one that first identified, and that was back in the 1800s. He was the first one that wrote about Parkinson's disease. But there are people that swear up and down that it's acknowledged in the Bible, and we know that some of the Greek writers acknowledged Parkinson's. So apparently it's been around for a long time. It's not a new disease. And I should mention, by the way, that Dr. James Parkinson's was a horticulturist in his spare time, and he particularly raised tulips. And that's why, if you didn't know, because Pauline She disappeared. Pauline didn't know until last night. That's why we call our newsletter the Tulip Messenger, because the tulip is the international symbol for Parkinson's disease. And there is a specific tulip that they developed in honor of Dr. Parkinson's just a few years ago, and they call it the Parkinson's tulip. And so we have coined that as our thing. When we think about Parkinson's disease, we think about what the doctors refer to as idiopathic. And that's just a fancy word that means run-of-the-mill. But the reality is that Parkinson's covers is kind of an umbrella term that a lot of people are thrown into. And then sometimes they're kind of ferreted out into different categories. But again, when we think about Parkinson's, it's that umbrella term that we use. But there are other what we call atypical or Parkinson's plus syndromes. The four most common are cortical basal degeneration, also known as CBD. Thankfully, they abbreviate these. PSP, or progressive supranuclear palsy. And then we have multiple system atrophy, or MSA. And then the last one, and the most common one, is what the Alzheimer's Association calls Alzheimer's with Parkinson's, or Alzheimer's Lewy body disease. We just call it Lewy body. And it's a different thing altogether. Typically you develop the Alzheimer's type symptoms and maybe some psychosis early on in the disease, which may or may not happen with regular run-of-the-mill Parkinson's disease. But they also have the Parkinson's symptoms. Now the bad news, and if you have any of those, then I'm going to preface it with this. You are in the driver's seat when you have Parkinson's disease. And your attitude about the disease, or if you have one of the Parkinson's plus syndromes, your attitude can change the whole ballgame and what you decide to do. Because if you have one of the atypical or Parkinson's plus, it will affect your life. Most of the time, those diseases are 5 to 10 year diseases, meaning from diagnosis to death, it's about 5 to 10 years. But we have a lady in Lubbock, matter of fact, I have a couple of ladies in Lubbock who have had PSP diagnosed, and by the way, that is one that as the brain deteriorates, they can actually see it in brain scans, and one of the characteristics of it is a bird's beak deterioration. It literally looks like they've implanted a bird's beak in your brain scans, and she has a definite, both of these ladies, excuse me, have definite bird's beak deterioration, or PSP, and yet one lady has had it for almost 30 years, and she's still blowing and going. Well, she slowed down tremendously the last few months, but she's still blowing and going. But it's her brute determination that has kept her going. And she is not going to let Parkinson's or Parkinsonism be her downfall. And I would challenge you to do the same thing. As someone said the other day at a support group meeting, and I'm sure you've heard it, I may have Parkinson's, but
Parkinson's doesn't have me.
It doesn't have me. If you have Parkinson's, I want you to repeat that real quickly. I may have Parkinson's, but
Parkinson's
doesn't have me. Don't let Parkinson's disease define who you are. Okay? Don't let Parkinson's define you who you are. You are still Joe or Nancy or John or whomever, and you still have a lot to contribute to this world. And I hope since we're in a church I can say this, I promise that's true, because if it were not true, if you didn't have things to still contribute, you wouldn't still be here. God would have taken you already. So I know that you're here for a purpose, and keep that in mind. So don't let this disease define who you are. Okay, there's a little, I don't even know what you call it, a little help reminder that doctors came up with to help people remember what the cardinal symptoms of Parkinson's are. It's a little thing called TRAP, T-R-A-P, TRAP. And those are the four cardinal symptoms of Parkinson's. But as most of you know, that doesn't even begin to really scratch the surface of what Parkinson's really is. The T stands for tremor. And that's what most people think about when they think about Parkinson's, is the tremor. But really, only about 50% of the people that have Parkinson's have a tremor, at least initially. Parkinson's tremor is very unique. It is a resting tremor, so that when you first develop the disease, for sure, it's very noticeable that as long as you're using your muscles, you don't see the tremor. It's when you have it sitting in your lap, but all of a sudden that tremor appears. And that tremor may not even look like a tremor when it first starts. Matter of fact, we have a condition called pill rolling, and that's how oftentimes that tremor first begins. That doesn't look like a tremor at all, does it? But that's what people will do. They will do this with their hand. Sometimes it begins in a toe. And literally, it's just like that little pinky toe has a mind of its own, and every once in a while, it just kind of does that. Well, that's not much of a tremor. But oftentimes, that's the initial beginning of Parkinson's. Parkinson's then will begin, and by the way, regardless of your symptoms, it will always start on one side of the body and eventually continue to the other side of the body. Maybe for a long time, all you have is that little pill rolling. But eventually, the tremor will appear. Now, if you go to a doctor, and I'm going to have to put this down for a minute so I can use my hands, but I think you can still hear me.
Yeah.
A lot of times when you go to a doctor on exam, they're going to have you put your hands out like this, and you may not notice a tremor, right? But eventually it comes back, and the reason that you don't notice it is because as soon as you do this, you've engaged all these muscles, right? And so that's why it has to reappear. And it will eventually come, and you'll be able to see it. Another thing about the Parkinson's tremor is a very rhythmic tremor. Sometimes you'll see somebody with a type of tremor, and it's just kind of all over the place. Parkinson's tremor is a very rhythmic tremor. Now, don't confuse that with this Parkinson's dance that people do. That's totally, completely different. Do you all know what that's called? Yeah, the dyskinesia. I heard someone say it. The dyskinesia. That's really more from the medications than from the disease itself, and we'll talk about that in a moment. But the tremor is very unique. Michael J. Fox, you know, the young actor that has Parkinson's, he figured this little trick out a long time ago. He discovered way back when he was doing the Spin City, not too long after he was diagnosed, he figured out that as long as he was using his muscles, no one could tell that he had Parkinson's disease. So if you go back and watch Spin City, he placed things on his set that you might find in an office. This was the first thing I grabbed that you might find in an office, but he used, you'll go back and watch those shows, he would put tape dispensers and he would put staplers around, and then he would go pick those up, and I don't know if I can do that with this, but he would throw them from hand to hand while he was saying his lines, because as long as he was using his muscles, you didn't see his tremor. And then he would I don't have pockets, I thought I did. Then he would put his hands in his pockets, and that's when you'd see the tremor, except he would have something like change in his pockets, and what man doesn't play with the change in their pockets, right? So it looked very natural, but it was just a cover-up to hide that tremor that he had. So that's the T in our tremor, in our trap is tremor. R is rigidity, and this is the one that people think is not Parkinson's, and oftentimes they blame it on arthritis, but it's really their Parkinson's. And the difference is arthritis is in the joints. The rigidity of Parkinson's disease is in the muscles. But it's hard sometimes to differentiate between the two. There's another little thing that I should tell you. Other than a few people who have young onset or juvenile Parkinson's, Parkinson's is complicated by our age, right? I don't know how many of you are over the age of 50, but as I look out over the group, I see a lot of you are. And really, it doesn't even have to be 50, because sometimes when we're about 40 years old, this kind of creeps in. Matter of fact, about the time that you were 40, you may have noticed that you had to start growing longer arms as you tried to read things, right? Because your eyes started to wear out. So let me say this, and keep this in mind as well. Parkinson's is complicated by aging. Or to say it another way, aging complicates Parkinson's. Or maybe Parkinson's, I don't know. But anyway, you get the idea. Because a lot of the symptoms that we have with Parkinson's, we also just have because we're aging. Have you noticed, for instance, that you're a little more rigid in the morning when you try to get out of bed, with or without Parkinson's? Look at your spouse or caregiver that doesn't have Parkinson's. Sometimes it's hard to tell early in the morning when you try to get out of bed. I used to make fun of my mother in a nice way because she would get up out of a chair and, you know, she'd kind of do this. Well, I'm not nearly as old as she was when she started doing that, and you're going to notice today if I sit for a long period of time, it takes me about halfway across the room before I can straighten up all the way. So rigidity is common as we age, but it's very common with Parkinson's. Matter of fact, rigidity is not in the joint, it's actually in the muscle. I'm already out of time? Oh, sorry. I forgot I set it down. Forgot to pick it back up. Sorry. So the rigidity is in the muscle, not in the joint. But oftentimes on exam, the doctors will take your wrist and they'll take your elbow and they're going to manipulate it so that they can feel the rigidity even if you don't. And sometimes it's to the point that we call what they call cogwheeling. So when you try to move your elbow out, it literally feels like it's going through a series of gears. That's how taut or tight those muscles can become. So that's the rigidity that we experience with Parkinson's disease. The A in our little acronym here, or whatever you call it, A stands for akinesia, which literally, kinesia is always associated with movement, and the A literally means without movement. And that may be true at the very end of the disease, but for most of you, a better term would be bradykinesia. You may have heard that term. I think the doctors use the A so it would fit into their thing. But bradykinesia is probably a better term to describe what you experience. And that slowness of movement. Again, the kinesia always means movement. Slowness of movement. And chances are you have noticed that you've slowed down. And it doesn't just affect your outward body, it affects your entire body. Anything that is affected by nerves and in turn muscles will be affected by your Parkinson's disease. So your GI tract, for instance, your GI tract is just a series of muscles. And guess what? It's affected by Parkinson's, right? One of the most common complaints is constipation, the C word, because it slowed down. Now remember what I said about aging a while ago? How many of you are not as quick as you were when you were 30? Or maybe 40. You can't chase the grandkids around quite as fast, right? When they get into trouble, you can't get there as quickly. So again, it's complicated by aging because just the aging process causes us to be slower than we once were. The P, sorry, I'm having to come get my fan. The P stands for, anyone know? Postural instability. That's a fancy way of saying you're going to have gait problems, balance issues. It's going to affect the way that you walk, the way that you stand. And I'm fixing to ask a volunteer. I need someone who does not have Parkinson's to volunteer for me. Someone? Okay, would you mind? Yes, ma'am. Way back there. Yes, ma'am, you. I can't read your name tag from that far away, sorry.
Okay.
I'm over 40. My reading vision is gone, and now my extended vision is going. And you are Karen. Okay, Karen, I want you to do a very simple thing.
Okay.
I want you to walk over about to the door. You don't have to go all the way. Turn around and walk back. And before she does that, I want you all to be very observant of her venture across the stage up here.
Okay.
And then come on back. And then I'm going to ask you to kind of do the same thing because I kind of blew it there when I didn't give you good directions. So just keep going until I tell you to stop. Just back and forth until I tell you to stop. And there's a reason that I'm doing that, not just to humiliate you, sorry. Okay, you can stop now. Okay, you're going to see in just a moment why I made her keep doing that. What did you observe? Don't go away. What did you observe about Karen's walk?
Arms were swinging.
That's it?
Consistent motion.
Consistent, very good. Consistent motion. Very smooth, right? What else?
Looked straight ahead.
She did. She looked straight ahead. Now, every once in a while, she'd glance down, but she looked straight ahead, right? What about her posture? Pretty erect, right? What else? Did you notice her gait? Her even. She took pretty long stride or had a pretty long stride, right? Anything else? Well, you all probably couldn't see it, but she walked in a very straight line. And the reason that I had her go back and forth is because I wanted to point out something else. When she turned, now not when she thought that was all she was going to do, but when she turned, did you notice what she did? She planted her foot and very quickly spun around, almost like a little ballerina, right? She almost did a little pirouette, I think they call it. Okay, I'm going to want you to watch what happens when I ask you not to swing your arms.
Okay.
You can't put them in your pocket.
Okay.
Hold them to your side, and now do the exact same thing back and forth.
Okay.
Do y'all notice any differences?
It's not quite as flowing and smooth.
Okay, not quite as flowing and smooth. Somebody used the word rigid. You could tell her rigidity right there, right?
Yeah.
I won't make her stand up here anymore. Let's give Karen our thank you for letting me humiliate you in front of lots of people. What else did you notice?
Posture wasn't as good.
As a matter of fact, immediately, did you notice what happened when I asked her to put her hands to her side? She hadn't even taken a step, and immediately, now she still stands up pretty tall, but she immediately bent over. Her head, where was it this time?
Straight up.
The second time, was it straight up?
She was looking at you.
Yeah, she was. She looked at me the whole time, except when she was looking at the floor. Did you notice that she spent a lot more time looking at the floor? Anything else? Do you notice that first step? Did you see what she did? She couldn't even, that's right, and she hesitated. Do you all ever hesitate with your Parkinson's before you do something or before you say something? That's a common thing. Now, let me make this perfectly clear, because I used this little guinea pig demonstration the other day, and someone said, oh, so not swinging your arm causes Parkinson's. No. I want you to make sure you understand this. I had to come up with an idea, some way of demonstrating this to a group of high school students that can't really relate to getting older because they're still so young, they just, you know. And so I thought, okay, what can we do? And guess what? You don't swing your arms. And by the way, one of the early symptoms of Parkinson's is what? Lack of an arm swing. And when you don't swing your arm, it changes everything. It messes with your brain. That's why, by the way, you're not swinging your arm, but it messes with your brain. And as soon as you take away that arm swing, because your arms are what keep you in balance when you walk and when you stand. I don't know if you've ever noticed, but when you stand, you immediately move your feet a little bit apart, except when you have Parkinson's. And this is a thing that frustrates our therapist, because Parkinson's patients put their feet together. Yeah. And it's not a good thing. So consciously, you need to remind yourself all the time, spread your legs apart. And that sounds really nasty, but spread your legs apart. Not what your mother taught you, ladies, but do it. And when you stand, you have to spread your legs apart. I'm sorry, that sounded very vulgar, and I didn't really mean for it to, but keep your legs apart, because that's one of the things. You become very, and this is true of Parkinson's, you fold in on yourself. You become very small. And did you notice that she's a tall lady? But did you notice what happened? Even her, that's bad grammar, but she even became smaller. She started folded in on herself. And as I look around the room, many of you have Parkinson's. That's what you're doing. You're folding in on yourself. Not only physically, but mentally as well. Because we know that one of the things that you do is you begin to withdraw. And there's a reason for that, and we'll talk about that in a moment as well. But you're going to have to force yourself. And by the way, you're still capable with Parkinson's of doing everything that you've ever been known to do. It just doesn't come easy anymore. So you have to force yourself to stand up. And people say, oh, I can't do that anymore. And then when they've gone through the big program, am I out of time?
No.
When they've gone through the big program, I don't know if you are aware of BIG, but BIG is a physical therapy program designed just for Parkinson's patients. And it retrains your brain to do big things, because you don't do that anymore. I don't know if you noticed, but her step got a lot smaller. And that's for a reason, because when you take away that arm swing and you have to now find a new center of gravity or a new center of balance, you bend forward. Posture is interrupted. Look around the room. Parkinson's patients are bending over. Now, we do that as we age, too. But it's complicated by your Parkinson's. Your steps have to get smaller. Because if you don't believe me, those of you who don't have Parkinson's, try that this afternoon. Try to take a big step when you're leaning over. It's virtually impossible to do. So Think big. Retrain yourself to stand up tall, to make big motions, to swing your arms. And believe it or not, you can regain the ability to swing your arms, to keep your legs apart when you're standing and when you're walking, and to take those big steps again. And it will improve your quality of life. Okay, so those are our demonstrated. The last one, the postural instability and gait problems, those are all identified in that TRAP, which are the cardinal symptoms. And I believe the doctor is going to talk about the secondary symptoms. But let me tell you that while those are the cardinal symptoms, there are some things that probably happened to you long before those outward symptoms of Parkinson's manifest. For instance, we know that a huge percentage, maybe as many as high as 60% of Parkinson's patients lose their ability to smell years before they have Parkinson's disease. Now, it's not necessarily not being able to smell everything, but there are some interesting key things that we in the United States are used to. Now, they came up with this smell test a few years ago, and they took it across the pond to Europe, and they thought it was going to work over there, and guess what? They don't smell the same things we do. Our olfactory system has, that's our smeller, has adapted to the things that were common. For instance, some of the things that we can't smell if you have Parkinson's, spearmint or mint, have a hard time smelling that. Well, a lot of doctors, neurologists, carry a little cotton swab with them and it has mint, and they'll, can you smell that? Can you smell that? And most Parkinson's patients can't. Spearmint and peppermint and that sort of thing. Pepperoni pizza. I can't imagine not being able to smell pepperoni pizza. But a lot of times Parkinson's patients can't. In Europe, they didn't have the same problems. They could smell pepperoni pizza. I thought that was kind of odd. Cantaloupe is a common thing that people can't smell here if they have Parkinson's. So it's not across the board. You don't necessarily lose your sense of smelling everything, but certain things. But again, I hate to say this, guess what? As we age, our olfactory system is also affected, and we begin to lose our sense of smell. So again, see how all of this is kind of complicated by the aging process. Another common problem early on, before you ever had Parkinson's perhaps, or before you were ever diagnosed with Parkinson's, and by the way, that's another thing too, you had to have lost about 50 to 70% of the dopamine-producing or dopaminergic cells in the brain before you had any of these outward manifestations of Parkinson's. Now, not the others, but for any of the outward ones that we think about, the trap that we think about. Another one, though, that is very common in Parkinson's and probably one of the most difficult ones in some ways is what we call REM behavior disorder. And this is a complicated subject, but I'll try to put it into a little bitty capsule. Our REM sleep is that deep sleep that we go into every night, and we rotate in and out of it. And every one of us, our period of REM sleep is different. For some people, I'll just say it's between probably 45 minutes on average to about an hour and a half that people are in this deep, deep sleep. And there are several stages of sleep, but this is the deep sleep where your body does most of its repairing and where you do most of your dreaming, and you are totally out of it. And they call it REM sleep because during that time, and that REM, by the way, stands for rapid eye movement. And during that part of your sleep, there is nothing moving except your eyeballs. Everything else is completely still. Literally, because we now know that there is a chemical that spreads over the movement part of your brain during that REM sleep, and it, for lack of a better term, paralyzes you. Unless you have what is called REM behavior disorder, or RBD. And this is very common in Parkinson's patients. It's common in some other diseases, but it's very common in Parkinson's. And again, about 50 to 60% of patients have it. And if you have this REM behavior disorder, you're missing that chemical that paralyzes you. And that's probably a bad term, but that incapacitates you. How's that? It incapacitates you. And so when you have REM behavior disorder and you're dreaming, for instance, I guess we're in Viking country, right? No? I didn't mean it. Boy, y'all are really sports fanatics. I should have known better. It's Green Bay pitcher. I meant like Vikings that came over here a long time ago. Isn't that from this part
Vikings.
Of the world? Or pirates or whatever. I don't know. But if you're dreaming that you're a pirate, I'll change it. A pirate, and you're swashbuckling somebody, and you're having a fight with someone, you literally may be up and having a sword fight. To the point that they've done these studies on Parkinson's patients. I went to a special conference a few years ago on sleep disorders and Parkinson's, and they had videotapes of Parkinson's patients that were undergoing sleep studies. And these were patients that oftentimes could barely modulate. I mean, they literally were using walkers and what you think about in advanced Parkinson's. And they would go to sleep, and because of their REM behavior disorder, those people who could barely walk moments before literally were up running around the room. They sometimes had bars on the beds to keep them from rolling out of bed, and they literally would crawl over those bars and run around the room. And it's because of this malfunction in the brain. Now, what does that tell you, that they're faking during the daytime? No, they're not. And when they showed the videotapes to these patients, they were appalled. That can't be me. I can't hardly walk. But the reality was, it was them. Now, I'm going to say this as a cautionary thing, because oftentimes people who have REM behavior disorder are sleeping with their spouse or loved one. And that can pose a huge problem for all sorts of reasons. Because here's another typical thing that happens. Because of this sleep disorder and because of your medications and other things, Parkinson's patients often don't get good sound sleep at night. So then during the day, they're snoozing often. And that's for a lot of reasons. And by the way, we don't want you to get your nights and days mixed up. And sometimes that's what happens. You are up and down all night, and so then you sit in a recliner and sleep all day. Except your loved one or your caregiver, they can't do that because they have to be up cleaning house and washing clothes and maybe going to a job. And so if you're not getting good sleep at night and you're in the same room with them, then chances are they're not getting good sleep at night either. And that's not fair for a lot of reasons. But more importantly, I'll tell you a true story that happened a few years ago. One of my Parkinson's families, and I consider you, as a matter of fact, I forgot to mention this, but I have a large Parkinson's family. When I started this job 20 years ago, someone said, now you're going to get real attached to these people. And I was newly divorced, and I did not want to be really attached to anyone. And I said, no, I've done jobs like this before, and I am not going to get attached to my Parkinson's patients. And that's what I called them, Parkinson's patients. And I went my very first day on the job. I got on a plane. I've never even set foot in my office. And I got on a plane and went to a national conference in Nashville, Tennessee. And I rode a shuttle from the airport to the hotel. And in that shuttle were several Parkinson's families, husbands and wives. And before I got to the, I got chills up my spine just then, no joke. Before I got to the hotel, you as a family had already crawled under my skin, if you want to say it that way, and I had become attached to my Parkinson's family. And that's why I've been doing this for 20 years. And that's why I will continue to do this, Lord willing, until we find a cure for this nasty disease. Now, I don't know that I can keep traveling because I drive all over the state of Texas and New Mexico. And if you think it's a long way from the Upper Peninsula to the Lower Peninsula, you don't know nothing until you come to Texas. And I don't mean that in a derogatory way, but it's a whole different world in Texas and New Mexico. And it's a long way of miles and miles of nothing but miles and miles. But the reality is that you all are my family, and I love you dearly. I'm just starting to meet some of you. But this is what happened. There was a patient who had REM behavior disorder, and he was asleep, and he had some very, what we call, violent dreams or vivid dreams because of his RBD. And one night he dreamed that someone was in his bedroom. Someone was in his bed with him. And so he reached over and grabbed a lamp and came crashing down on his wife with that lamp. Now, he's sound asleep. fortunately, when he jostled around in the bed, it woke her up, and she put her arm up like this and blocked it. But I will tell you, and by the way, the next morning he didn't remember any of it. She had a huge bruise, and it's a wonder it didn't break her arm, but it could have been much worse. I have thought about that so many times, because can you imagine what the newspaper would have said the next morning? Husband kills wife. You know, y'all are laughing, and it is kind of funny, but not so very much, because he had no recollection that he'd even done it at all. And that's the way it is with REM behavior disorder. So I'm going to tell you all this. If you are a husband and wife and you're still sleeping together and one of you has Parkinson's and has RBD, you have my permission. Matter of fact, more than that, I encourage you, snuggle, do whatever you do in bed, and then get up and go to a separate bedroom, because we do not want you to become a statistic. And like I said, that's the worst case scenario. The best case scenario is your sleep is just interrupted, and that's not fair either. So move to another bedroom. And I know that doesn't sound very romantic, but like I said, you can do all those things that you do in bed and then move to another bedroom. And I know some of you think, oh, we don't do that anymore, but that's a bunch of baloney. I've discovered that.
5 minutes.
Okay, I forgot to tell you, you asked me about the age, but I forgot to tell you that Parkinson's disease affects initially what we call the substantia nigra. And if you were to take your little finger and pull it up like this in the center of your brain or center of your face, and if you were to go right here at the top of your ear, kind of the back at the top of your ear, where those two points intersect, down in the very midbrain is where we find the substantia nigra. And years ago, 20 years ago, when I started this, they thought that was all that was affected by Parkinson's. That's kind of the movement area of your brain. And they had identified that one neurotransmitter called dopamine. And they thought, that's all that's affected by Parkinson's. And guess what we now know? That just isn't so. Unfortunately, Parkinson's kind of spreads out, and we know that it affects other parts of the brain, like the thinking part, your frontal part of your brain where you think and where you learn new things and all sorts of things like that. We also know that there are a dozen neurotransmitters that are affected by your Parkinson's, not just dopamine. And while that may sound a little depressing, guys, that's good news, because the more we learn about this disease, two things. The more we learn, the more we realize that we really don't know. But secondly, the closer we are to finding what really triggers this disease. People always want to know about a cure. We don't have one yet, and I'll just be really harsh. Any of you that have ever done anything in science know that this is true. You cannot find a cure for a disease until you find out what causes it. And while we've identified 39 genes that are now involved and a whole bunch of other things, we still don't know what causes it. But there's good news. There are a lot of things happening. Matter of fact, I told you that supposedly this goes back all the way to the Bible or maybe before. Nothing really happened with Parkinson's disease until 1960, or until the 60s, not a specific date. And you all may remember the movie that Robin Williams was in called Awakenings.
Yes.
That movie was about the discovery of dopamine replacement, which is carbidopa levodopa, or dopamine, which is a replacement for the natural dopamine. And they didn't discover that until the 60s. And then, quite frankly, not a whole lot happened until the 70s. And then just in the last 20 years since I've been doing this, they have made remarkable discoveries. And we have dozens of treatments now for your Parkinson's disease. And there are new ones coming all the time. More importantly, and I'm going to say this repeatedly today, just like I want you to remember, that you as a Parkinson's patient are just like a little snowflake. There are no two of you alike. And I also want you to remember this. All of the medications that you take, all they do are treat the symptoms of your disease. The one thing that we know treats the disease, can slow the progress, and in some cases even reverse the disease, is this little magic bullet called exercise. And if you're not exercising on a daily basis, then you are cheating yourself out of a treatment for Parkinson's that is absolutely free. And you can say, well, what kind of exercise? Well, there's a center up in Boston that they've researched this and researched this and researched this, and the specialist up there, Dr. Terry, said, been at conferences where she's actually said this, which one's the best? And this is her answer. Whichever exercise you're going to do on a daily basis. If it's riding a bike, then ride a bike. If it's walking, then walk. If it's swimming, then swim. If it's walking in the water, and here's a good one, if you have balance problems, the best place that you can probably be is in the water for a lot of reasons. And by the way, if you, as we age, how many of you have arthritis? Walking or exercising in a swimming pool is fantastic because it takes all the pressure off your joints. And if you have Parkinson's and you happen to fall, chances are you're going to be able to not get too badly hurt in a swimming pool. Now, I will always say this, as a Parkinson's patient, do not exercise alone, because you might fall, even in that swimming pool. So always have an exercise buddy with you. And that may be hard for some people like Pauline, but even riding a bicycle, I noticed she has a bicycle in the room that she put me in last night. She has a bicycle in there, and it's great, except sometimes Parkinson's patients start to list while they're riding a bicycle, and you can literally fall off of that thing. Or if you're using a treadmill, that's great, but if you're walking on a treadmill, do not, as a Parkinson's patient, walk on a treadmill unless you have one of those belts around you so that if you happen to fall, it cuts it off. Because I saw a Parkinson's patient years ago that religiously walked on a treadmill every day, an electric treadmill, and one day he fell. And guess what? He fell face first, and the treadmill did not stop, and he could not get up, and it looked like someone had run over his face. Because you know how difficult it is to move when you have Parkinson's. She's going to kick me out, so I'm going to shut up. I appreciate it, and I'll be back to answer questions later.
We're going to hear more from her for sure today. I told you she talks a lot, and she has a lot to say. Is Dr. Peterson here by any chance? I don't know if she's come yet. But we are going to draw for some prizes. I need the tickets. Does someone have the tickets down there? I need the ticket bowl. Has spoken to our local support group before on various topics concerning Parkinson's disease. She's our local neurologist, presently at Dickinson Neurology, just down the street a little way. She's a graduate of Iron Mountain High School and Northern Michigan University. She then attended Wayne State University School of Medicine, graduating in 1980. She's a retired associate professor of neurology at Wayne State School of Medicine and a past chief of neurology and a director of neurotrauma ICU at Detroit Recovery Hospital. Fortunately for those of us in this area, her present practice focuses on Parkinson's disease. And that's where I met her, and that's how I got this job. She's been an avid supporter of having a support group for PD patients and their families. I needed a support group. She encouraged me to start one. Dr. Peterson.
See, for those of you who know me, that doggone back of mine, so you're going to see me shift from side to side. But okay, what I wanted to talk to you about.
Can I hear you?
Let me move closer. How's that? No? Is there a volume on this? Now?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, just kind of lean into it, I guess. What I wanted you to talk to you today about is everybody seems to think, or most folks think, that Parkinson's is just a movement disorder. It's only motor problems. and that's usually how the disease presents. What I want to talk to you about is how I got interested in Parkinson's, because it relates to thoughts about where the disease is going in the future. My interests at the medical school, when you're down there, you have to have research interests, so you're never going to advance in the faculty. I was always interested in, well, it's a long name, but don't get overwhelmed by it. It's mitochondrial oxidative phosphorylation. But, okay, it just has to do with aging. It's what happens to cells as they age. And as I often tell my patients, if you got old enough, every single person would develop signs of Parkinson's. That's why you see patients in their late 90s, some in their hundreds. They tend to be walk more bent over, movement is slow, and you see characteristics that are typical of Parkinson's. Well, why does that happen? My belief has always been, and some people do agree with me, is that this process that I was talking to you about, which is how cells die, my mouth is so dry, is related to what happens with Parkinson's. There's a group of diseases called neurodegenerative diseases. Cells die and we don't know why. And when it happens in a certain area, you get particular clinical features. So I was interested in Parkinson's mainly because it does involve cells in a particular area. My research tried to figure out why cells die normally. Obviously, people age, and in different diseases, certain cell types die. Well, it involves this process. I'm not going to say it again because it's just somewhat overwhelming. It has to do with how cells make energy. As you know, the body is made of little cells that have different functions: skin cells, liver cells, muscle cells, and brain. Most of the cells in the body regenerate, but the brain cells don't. The connections do, but not the cells themselves. So the interesting issue from my perspective was, is there anything we can do to affect that? As to, you know, preventing cells from being damaged and dying. So it was a matter of if you dissect the process, and my interest was that little part of the cell that makes energy. That's the mitochondria. Every cell obviously needs energy in order to survive. So why do some cells, like in neurodegenerative disorders, die? Or why do any cells die? How do people age? So what we discovered is that there's a process, and that's the oxidative phosphorylation. That's just the chemical reason why cells lose the ability to make energy. Obviously, when that happens, the cell dies. So my major interest was, what can we do to stop that from happening? And it appears, and you see, you probably noticed this in the press and some of the research areas, are attempts to block that from happening. And it relates to a condition called oxidative stress. I know, here we go again. But it's the process in the body that damages the ability of those little parts of the cell to make energy. And that was the research, was to try and figure out what we could do to block those parts of the cell from dying. And that's how I got interested in Parkinson's, because it's obviously a disease that's characterized by those particular cells in the body dying before they're supposed to. Like I said, they, yes?
Is hyperbaric treatment a positive thing in that case?
No, it's used for a more acute type of cell damage. Oh, that's okay. So, going back to this, with the emphasis on trying to find something to block the cells dying, the process that we pursued was what's called antioxidant treatment. Now that you've probably heard about in the press. And those are things like vitamin E, fish oil, turmeric. And if you can keep those little parts of the cell from dying, they live longer and the disease doesn't progress. In the past, there was a drug they marketed ages ago, which was way too expensive, did the same thing that fish oil did. And the idea there was to help the cells protect, keep them from dying, a neuroprotective type of treatment. But then they discovered that there's many drugs that exist that are actually vitamins that are out on the market that do the same darn thing. So there was no way they could, you know, substantiate getting people to invest in producing that drug, which is kind of where things are at now. Is you don't see it marketed at all because there's no money to be made in it, so the drug companies don't chase it down. But this was my research. The only drug, well, it's not a drug, it's an over-the-counter substance that is available. Well, there's fish oil, there's vitamin E, but turmeric or curcumin is the only drug I've seen that's been proven to be effective in slowing down Parkinson's. And that original research was actually done at Michigan State University. Now you're probably going to ask, why is it said that the reason Parkinson's advances is because you form more of those little bodies, Lewy type bodies? And that's just a marker. The reason those small parts of the cell are formed is because the cell loses the ability to form the little vesicles that allow one cell to talk to another. And that's at the crux of Parkinson's problems. The first cells that are most sensitive are the ones that produce dopamine. And there's many, many reasons why those cells can be damaged. Normal aging is one of them. The other reasons that those cells can get damaged are, for example, poisonings. People who are dry cleaners, work in welding, healthcare workers, can also be exposed to chemicals that damage that area of the brain. People who spray pesticides or are poisoned with trichloroethylene, those are, you're exposed to that a lot in the environment. Some folks are more susceptible to having damage from those particular chemicals. And as the prior speaker said, no two Parkinson patients are alike. It's not really a disease, it's more of a syndrome. And different people have different problems. Some people have primarily movement problems. Some people have primarily problems maintaining their blood pressure. Because when they stand, the blood pressure drops. So each patient has different problems, and you have to fine-tune the treatment for each person based on what their primary problem is. Some people tremor, some people rigidity. Some people, and a very early sign that you get with Parkinson's is constipation, or loss of smell and loss of taste is another one that they've used to screen for Parkinson's. And some of my new patients have been extremely frustrated. They come in and see me, and I make the diagnosis of Parkinson's, and they say, how can you do that without a blood test or an MRI of the brain? Or there is no specific diagnostic test for Parkinson's. It's based on the clinical features that the patient has. But those clinical features are how you treat the disease. I think they will get to the point at someday where there is some type of chemical blood test that can be done. In hereditary Parkinson's disease, it's more straightforward. It's a gene problem. And that can be passed on from, you know, one parent to the children. But if you look at those genes, they have to do with oxidative phosphorylation, the ability to detoxify oxygen damage to that little part of the cell. So it all comes back to that. And I have my own opinions about, you know, what happens with neurodegenerative problems, and this is how I got interested in it, because I do believe this is at the crux of what causes Parkinson's. Now, what I was supposed to specifically concentrate on today were non-motor problems that are associated with Parkinson's. Not just movement problems, but what else is affected in the body. You can have what's called dementia with Parkinson's. And that's where you have increasing difficulty with your thinking and interacting with the environment. Dementia in Parkinson's is different than the typical dementia that people get. Alzheimer's type of dementia is predominantly presents with short-term memory problems. And it's a totally different disease. Those two are not related. I suppose people with Parkinson's could get Alzheimer's, but that's not the typical course. But the characteristics of people with dementia that's due to Parkinson's is that they have more of a problem with executive functions, not so much short-term memory early on. It's doing the finances for the family, operating the remote, putting together the new vacuum cleaner. Those are more of the type, multitasking. Those are more of the type of problems that people with Parkinson's dementia get, rather than what people commonly think of dementia, which is mostly short-term memory problems. And I think if we approach that differently than what people typically do with dementia, we're going to get better success in treatment and outcome. But the dementia that people typically talk about is different than Parkinson's dementia. It's executive function more, the frontal part of the brain. And that has pathways from the brainstem to that area. So yes, it is dopamine related. And sometimes when you adjust the drug, some of the issues that people have, you know, with dementia improve. So I just wanted to make a comment that those two are different. Sometimes they use the same drugs to treat it, which are usually the anticholinesterase inhibitors. But the cause is different. Another problem that is very common in Parkinson's disease are mood problems. At least half of all patients with Parkinson's have either anxiety or depression. But again, the depression that you see in Parkinson's is different than what most people have thoughts about characteristics of Parkinson's, of depression. In Parkinson patients, the depression isn't usually characterized by tearfulness or flatness. It's more an anxiety. It's anxiety based. People tend to get very anxious. And anybody in the room who has Parkinson's, you know darn well what happens when you get anxious. The movement problems get markedly worse. So controlling the anxiety is really an important thing to do. And that's managed differently than just putting somebody on an antidepressant. So anxiety is a very, very major component of mood problems with Parkinson's. The other thing I wanted to talk to you about were the autonomic problems that some folks get with Parkinson's. And sometimes that's actually how people present. And those various issues include problems maintaining the blood pressure. It's all the so-called autonomic. It's the things we don't have to think about. The body kind of takes care of it themselves. Like bowel function, digesting food, swallowing, regulating sweat. Those are all what we call autonomic features. And like I said, some people actually present with what's called orthostatic hypotension. I have very few Parkinson patients who are actually on blood pressure medicines, because the most commonly used drug, Sinemet, and the disease itself typically drop the blood pressure. it's something that, you know, it can occur anytime during the course of the disease, but what happens is you stand up, and instead of the blood vessels in the legs constricting, they dilate. They're not as well automatically controlled by the brain. So the blood pools in the legs. And the heart doesn't speed up its rhythm. Usually when the blood pressure drops, the heart beats faster, so you can keep perfusing the brain. But in this situation, blood pools in the legs, heart doesn't increase its rate, and the blood pressure drops. You get very dizzy, lightheaded, and have to sit down again, or faint, heaven forbid, and fall. Very common problem in Parkinson's disease, and doctors have to look for this. And some people, when they first develop the disease, have problems with blood pressure. As the disease progresses, you have to be extremely careful to watch that, because the blood pressure will come down. Cinnamon will cause it to come down, and the disease process itself will cause that to fall. Watch for it. So if you when you stand up, your meds need to be adjusted. Some folks aren't even on blood pressure meds, yet have such profound problems with blood pressure, they need to be on a medication to increase the blood pressure. Or every time they stand up, they can faint. Other issues that can occur with autonomic failure or problems with regulating different functions in the body, the GI tract, stomach and intestines. Anybody in this room who has Parkinson's knows constipation's a biggie. And that can cause all kinds of problems. And the reason for that is dopamine is the primary neurotransmitter for the gut. That's what regulates the bowel being able to contract and get wastes out of you. And some people have a really large problem with constipation. So you have to stay right on top of that. Adequate fluids, exercise, bulky types of food, fiber, and people can end up being hospitalized for recurrent problems with constipation. Another one you want to stay on top of. Some people can get chronic nausea, vomiting, because food doesn't go through the stomach like it should. And they get nauseated because of another reason or another problem related to autonomic function. You can get problems with sweating. The body doesn't regulate its core temperature as it's supposed to. You can have problems with being able to produce tears. A lot of folks who have Parkinson's will eventually develop this redness of the cheeks and redness of the rims of the eyelids, sometimes get blurred vision, and that has to do with, it's called seborrheic dermatitis. That is actually a skin problem is caused by the Parkinson's. But if it's left untreated, you develop blurred vision with it. And you can end up with bacterial infections of the eyelids. So it's yet another thing you want to stay on top of. Those are the big ones with autonomic issues, though. The last thing that I wanted to talk about before we, try to tie everything together is sleep. Sleep is a huge problem for most folks with Parkinson's. Normal sleep goes through four different stages, and it's the time of day when the brain is at its most active period. It's doing its house cleaning. It's getting rid of metabolites and waste from working all day. So there's four stages of it that the brain goes through to get rid of the waste. The problem in Parkinson's is sometimes initiating sleep. You can lay there for eons and you just can't fall asleep. In some folks, it's the sleep isn't maintained. It's up and down and up and down and you can't fall asleep again. In some folks, it's repeated movements of the legs, what we call periodic limb movements. It's when you try to doze off and go into another stage of sleep, the legs are moving so much you can't maintain sleep. Restless legs is also very common in Parkinson's. I have my own theory that in folks who have restless legs, there's a percentage of them that go on to develop Parkinson's. It's the most common movement disorder in the U.S. And for people who have ever had that, and some Parkinson patients do, you can't get your legs to essentially settle down. It feels like you always have to move them. And needless to say, this can be beyond annoying for patients because you can't settle down at night. And even during the day, you can have this problem. You're trying to sit and read a book or something, and you feel like you have to keep moving your legs. But that's also a dopamine-mediated problem. So some folks, before they get Parkinson's, will have a problem with restless legs. And they usually treat that in similar manners that they treat Parkinson's, with dopamine-related meds. Either Sinemet or Mirapex or Requip, trying to increase the level of dopamine to settle down that symptom. The most interesting part of sleep disorders are REM-related behavior disorders. And that's, I heard the speaker previously talking about this, it's absolutely fascinating. Usually when people go into this particular stage of sleep, they're paralyzed. They don't move. Now in Parkinson's, there's a twist to it. The limbs aren't, and you act out your dreams. You're flailing around or having nightmares and acting them out. So heaven forbid somebody sleeping with you, they're going to get punched, or I had one patient who bit his wife.
Oh my.
But that is a very common problem, are these REM-related issues. Usually they're not frightening or threatening, but it is something that commonly occurs. So if you're a spouse of a patient with Parkinson's, be wary. Because they can thrash around and talk in their sleep, chatter away, or get aggressive and, you know, take a swing at who's ever sleeping with them. And like the prior speaker said, go to another bedroom because you're going to have a lousy night's sleep. And if you think about it, the patient who's having this happen is also having a lousy night's sleep. So the doctor's going to want to know about this, because that can be managed with a medication. Okay, so we've talked about dementia, we've talked about mood problems, autonomic problems, and sleep. And these are all non-motor problems that people with Parkinson's have to keep an eye out for. And I haven't talked anything about treatment of Parkinson's or gotten into the medications or anything like that. But I did want to come back to what probably interests people the most, is where's the research going? You know, what do we have to look forward in the future? My own personal belief is that energy metabolism is at the crux of this. And it just happens to be that those particular conglomeration of cells are extremely sensitive to having low oxygen. And when that happens, those little areas of the brain, those mitochondria, get damaged. And they can no longer produce energy. So the cells die. And once again, if we can figure out a way to block that from happening, or at least slow the process down, we're going to impact on the diseases that are characterized by that. Does anybody have any questions? Yep.
In reading research on various supplements that claim to be neuroprotective, have you talked about them that you can go realistic?
The antioxidants. Fish oil, turmeric's probably the best. In turmeric, probably a gram twice a day or 2 grams twice a day.
Could you spell
that, please? It's T-U-R-M-E-R-I-C. It's an Indian spice. You don't want to get it on your hands, because they'll turn orange. Yes. But you can buy it. If you buy it in a grocery store, you'd have to buy a ton of it. They do make supplements, turmeric supplements. And like I said, that's the only research I know of that has actually shown objective documented evidence of impacting progression of Parkinson's.
If you have a question, say it really loud so everybody can hear.
Is the
relative measure of oxygen in your system. That a measure of?
No, unfortunately. It's not that simplistic. Yeah. No, it has to do with cellular damage. You get increasing damage to that little part of the cell that makes energy, and the cell's going to die. Happens in normal aging. The older you get, the more problems you have with sensitive cells that die. The skin will regenerate, the liver will regenerate, the brain, no. Anybody else?
Over here.
Here.
Yeah, I have a question. How do you treat that if somebody has internal problems like nausea and that kind of thing?
There are different drugs that can help with that. You have to be really careful because cinnamon itself can cause nausea. Some people can't take the drug because they get so nauseated with it. There are different medications that will help that. Droperidone is one of them. You can ask your doctor, you know, but you have to be very careful if the person has motor problems and you need to use Cinemet or an agonist. But a lot of folks who have Parkinson's are used to that delicate balance. Yep.
My father had cardiac arrest 4 years ago, and he literally didn't take oxygen in for like 20 minutes, but they zapped his heart and kept, you know, giving him the compressions. And he's here today. He'll be 85 on December 2nd. But since that happened, where he didn't get that oxygen for that period, he's gotten the tremors and all the things that you're talking about. So that I think they have diagnosed him with the Parkinson's.
Yeah, he may very well respond to replacing that chemical, the dopamine. But Parkinson's isn't that simple. It's not just dopamine, but it's the primary neurotransmitter.
I have to take carbapenem dopa, and I was wondering, am I supposed to take it at the same time all the time?
No, the patient, they tell you to do that.
Can you repeat the question?
Oh, they're asking whether or not you have to take Cinemet or carbidopa levodopa. I like Cinemet better, it's short. If you have to take it the same time of the day, the ideal way to take it is when you notice, you know your body well enough, you notice that your function is declining, you know, you pick up the first symptoms, then you take the drug. And that's going to vary. That's why they came up with this dopamine pump, where they actually implanted, you know, so you'd get continuous input of dopamine. But even with that situation, sometimes people went into dyskinesias, and some time people had tremors. So they're not
what she can't sleep.
It's leg pains or the.
It's leg pains. It's really bad enough. It's past the restless leg. It's actually pains in the legs, and it did stop that, the 300 milligrams, but it caused some other problems. So, like I said, she dropped back to 200. But she'd like to eliminate it entirely.
Yeah, what you need is a good diagnosis, because you typically don't get unless it's absolutely needed, because it's associated with more side effects than Cinemet is. And in particular, it can cause problems with impulse-related diseases. Patient becomes hypersexual, eats a lot, gambles.
Oh, no.
It can do that. So you have to be really careful when you use that drug. That's a monoamine oxidase inhibitor. It's called a monoamine oxidase inhibitor, and it prevents the dopamine from breaking down. It's not the same kind of drug as far as you take the pill, you get a reaction. You have to be on it a while before you see. They use it as a supplement if the Cinemet or the dopamine agonists tend to fail as time goes by. Yeah, I think you folks probably need a...
They need a break.
Yeah, you need a break. Need to stretch. And okay.
Thank you.
I'll stop there.
We have a lot more Dr. Peterson prizes, and we're going to be giving them away real soon. I think our 1 o'clock speaker is here, but hi. I'll come over and meet you in just a few minutes. We're going to take a break for lunch, and it will be about...
Parkinson's disease, and his father was a doctor as well. And I kept saying, Dr. Lahara, is there any legitimacy to pain? Because I read all the time, and they don't say there's any pain with Parkinson's. And yet every patient tells me that they're in dire pain because of their Parkinson's. And he said, Joe, I'll tell you about this neurology stuff and about this Parkinson's disease. When more neurologists develop Parkinson's, then we're going to find out that there's a lot more things like pain. And so that was his answer. But I will tell you that there is pain associated with Parkinson's, and the research is now saying that. Again, I don't know about the legs necessarily, but that is a common complaint. Excuse me. Patients used to complain about shoulder pain and not being able to use their shoulders. Well, latest research tells us that's because Parkinson's patients do develop what's called a frozen shoulder. And it goes back to, if you don't use it, you will lose it. Again, that exercise word comes into play there. If you are starting to get stiff in your shoulders, that's part of the stiffness or the rigidity we talked about. If you're starting to get that way and feel that rigid, then number one, you need to talk to your neurologist about adjusting your medication. And number two, you need to talk to a physical therapist about doing some therapy to specifically target the shoulders. That is painful. And they also know that there's pain in the lower back. And while they can't say that that's necessarily Parkinson's, that's one of the most common things people complain about, is my back is killing me all the time. It's probably due to the muscles tightening up, but it still is painful. And I suspect that it's painful in the legs as well, because a lot of patients tell me that that is the case. Real quickly, two more questions that were asked of me a while ago, and if I have forgotten some of your questions, I apologize. Sleep apnea study, will that diagnose REM behavior disorder? It will diagnose it. They can't give you a treatment for it if you have sleep apnea, other than putting you on a CPAP machine, and that's not going to affect the REM behavior disorder itself. Oh, someone asked me about neuropathy, because the doctor mentioned that a while ago. For those of you who don't know, and this is a very simplistic way of looking at it, but neuropathy is where we have nerve damage that occurs with things like diabetes and Parkinson's disease. And there was a new study that just came out about a month ago that said there's definitely a correlation between Parkinson's and neuropathy, and that Parkinson's patients seem to be more likely to develop it. What that literally is the nerves are affected so that you get a burning, a tingling sensation, and that eventually you may lose the ability to do fine motor skills and that sort of thing. For instance, button your shirts. Was that surprising if you have Parkinson's? No, because a lot of you find that difficult. So there is a correlation between neuropathy, and it may be due to a number of things, the disease itself and the aging process. Because as we age, we're more likely to develop neuropathy too, and it's probably for this reason. Vitamin B12, while some of you take vitamin B12 to give you energy, I can tell you that it doesn't do that. That's a placebo effect. It has absolutely no effect on producing energy. As a matter of fact, it's the only B vitamin that is not involved in metabolism and turning our food into energy. So it doesn't do that. But what it does affect are the nerves. And here's the problem. As we age, remember I told you a while ago protein is broken down in the stomach and we have to have acid to do that? We also have to have acid to break vitamin B12 off of protein. Vitamin B12 is only found in products that have protein naturally. Beef, chicken, fish, that's the only place that vitamin B12 comes. You can't get it on a plant. Only is attached to proteins. And the way that it's broken off in the stomach is with this stuff called stomach acid. And believe it or not, as we age, the acid in our stomach goes down. There's also this magic stuff called intrinsic factor. And we have to have intrinsic factor in order for our body to be able to utilize vitamin B12. And as we age, guess what? That goes down as well. And that's tied to another common problem in old age, and that is the development of stomach ulcers. A lot of times people go to the doctor and they're having bleeding rectally and they don't know what's causing it. And lo and behold, they discovered that you have an ulcer. And it's because, just like the skin that you see here on your hands, everybody look at your hands. Have you noticed that that's kind of thinning out? Doesn't look quite the same as it did, and the older we get, the more thin that gets. That same type of cell, skin, is what lines our stomach. And as we get older, it gets thinner. And as we get older, we're not really producing more stomach acid, we're actually producing less, but because of the skin thinning out and we're not producing as much of this nasty stuff called mucus to protect the stomach, it causes problems. So now we have a huge big storm developing because we have not enough acid. And by the way, we also contribute to that because how many of you are taking something called an acid reducer, like I can't even think of names of them all of a sudden, omeprazole or Prilosec. How many of you are taking that? Come on, raise your hands high, be proud. And doctors put people on that and they keep them on it for years. And if you'll go back and look at those drugs, you were supposed to be on it for 2 weeks. And some people have been on it for years and years. And that doesn't even count, by the way. That was the number one, when that set of drugs was prescribed, it was the number one prescription drug in America for years and years. And that didn't even count all the things like Alka-Seltzer and Rolaids and Tums that people took. Because as we age and our GI tract slows down, and we have these sphincter muscles that don't work as well. And so we get reflux back up from our stomach to our esophagus. But the problem is, we cannot break off that B12 and make it available to attach to that intrinsic factor and be used in our body without stomach acid. And so as we age, we have set up a perfect storm to develop neuropathy. My medical director I have in Lubbock now is a young doctor. She's been there about 5 years now, but when she came, her first 10 patients, she suspected had neuropathy. So she sent them down for a blood test to see if their vitamin B12 was reduced. 7 of those 10 patients had severely deficient levels of vitamin B12. Now, I told someone a while ago, I'm not a big proponent of supplements because, quite frankly, 90% of them don't work. It's something that a bunch of companies have made a whole bunch of money. Matter of fact, pharmaceutical companies and oil companies are the only ones that even compare to the amount of money that the companies that make these vitamin and mineral supplements have made over the course of the last 20 years. And most of them, when they've tested them, just don't do what they're supposed to do. But vitamin B12 is different. Apparently God knew that as we got old, vitamin B12 was going to be deficient in our bodies. And so we have this magic stuff. And you can take it sublingually, or you can take it by shot. And if you're deficient, this is what they're going to do. Because vitamin B12 is water soluble, meaning that it's broken down in water and we lose it out of our body all the time. So it has to be replaced. So if you're deficient, they're probably going to give you a shot, maybe even a shot every day for a week. And then maybe once a week for a period of time. And then they're going to put you on a supplement that you take by mouth. And it is the one that actually does work fairly well when taken by mouth. I think I didn't have time to talk about any new medications or things that are coming out, but I will tell you this, and I mean it with all honesty and sincerity, there has never been a time better than this to have Parkinson's disease. And I know that sounds crazy, but there are more drugs and more treatments available to you today than ever before. And there's more research going on today than ever before. And there are lots of good things that are happening in the field of neurology and the field of Parkinson's disease specifically. I'm going to have to tell one joke while she walks up here. Actually, I'm going to make it two. I was kind of crude before. I'm going to be crude again. This is one dirty joke I know. No joke. Why did the toilet paper cross the road? No one? It got caught in the crack. Okay, one more. I know we're Viking territory, not that kind of Viking, but the real, Vikings. It's a pirate joke, it's not a Viking joke. What's a pirate's favorite letter?
R.
That's what you would think, but really it's the C. No, it's weak.
Very, very bad. Laughter is almost as good as exercise for me.
Are you ready to go on to another speaker? Or would you like some prizes?
Yes.
Let's draw a few prizes.
like we are, 50 degrees, 38 at night. Got off the plane last night. That is not the case. It is totally different, 50 degrees. The second thing that I've noticed, there is no easy way to get to Iron Mountain, Michigan. Especially from Lubbock, Texas. There's no easy place to get there, easy way to get there either. And the third thing, in spite of what you all may think, I think y'all are the ones that talk funny. And notice I said y'all on purpose. I don't say that very often, but I did say y'all on purpose, so you would know that I really am from the South. Several people have handed me questions, and I'm going to try very diligently to try to answer them. Number one, several people have asked me about dystonia. And just to say real quickly, dystonia can be its own disease, for lack of a better word, all by itself. And a simplistic way, a couple of you have kind of given me a hard time teasingly about being very simple speaker. I am very simple. I have a very simple mind, so I speak very simply. I try to break things down where you all can understand it. That way I understand what I'm saying too. But dystonia, for lack of a better expression, is a condition where your muscles contract. And then over time, they can't relax. You can have that all by itself, but it's very, very common for Parkinson's patients to develop dystonia in various parts of their body. For instance, a lot of times your feet, people get dystonia in their feet, and their toes start to curl up to where people literally sometimes are walking around on the top of their feet. You can get it in any part of your body. We had a young doctor in Lubbock. He happened to be a specialist in something other than neurology, but he knew he probably had Parkinson's because it was very prevalent in his family. But his initial symptoms were muscle cramps in his legs and dystonia all over his body. And sure enough, he did end up having Parkinson's. But we had a golf tournament one day that he was pretty much behind. He put it on. And he had been out on the course. It was a miserably hot day in Lubbock. It was about 105, and we had been through, we'd had one previously in the fall of the year in October, and it actually snowed that day. So we moved the next one to early June, and we had just the opposite problem. It turned out to be super hot, and we'd already been through all the alcohol and water before noon, and so he was dying, and he came back on the golf cart, and he asked me to help him. And he literally had muscle cramps so bad that it looked like, and I'm not exaggerating, when he got off that in his little shorts, it looked like somebody had taken their fist and punched from inside his legs out. That's how bad the knots were. And those were his initial symptoms of Parkinson's disease. And if he hadn't had a family of Parkinson's, he probably would not have known to look at that. But again, dystonia is not necessarily a part of Parkinson's, but it's very, very common for people to have dystonia when they have Parkinson's. And that can be treated sometimes a number of ways. Number one, adjusting your medications, your Parkinson's medications may help. Number two, there are things that they can do like Botox or MyoBlock injections to relieve those muscle tightness. And there is a new drug that's being developed that's very similar to Botox or MyoBlock, and there's already one that's on the market. It's just under a different name. So there are a number of things that they can do, and they inject that into you. And it literally is botulism, so it's a toxin that they put into you, and so a lot of people have qualms with that. But it does successfully, in some cases, treat that. Now, several people have asked me about carbidopa-levodopa. And the levodopa or the levodopa part of that is the dopamine replacement for people that have Parkinson's. Dopamine is the neurotransmitter that all Parkinson's patients have a shortage of. You heard the doctor speak to that a while ago. So the carbidopa-levodopa is the replacement for that. It's a man-made replacement for that, the natural dopamine. Dopamine is an amino acid. And amino acids are what our proteins are made from. So I want you to listen very carefully, because this has been debated for a long time about doctors and neurologists, what I'm about to say. But I'm going to tell you this. Most doctors have not had one class in nutrition, not even one. So listen very carefully, because while I'm not an expert and while I may not look like it, I have been teaching nutrition on the college level for about 30 years, and I do an enormous amount of research, and this much I know. Dopamine that you take artificially in your carbidopa-levodopa will be affected by your diet. And some doctors say it's not, but I'm telling you, it just makes sense. And I'm going to tell you why. When you eat any food, and all food has some protein, every bite that you put in your mouth has some protein in it, because every living cell is made of protein or made of amino acids. So you always get a little bit of protein. Obviously, things like fish and fowl and beef and that sort of thing, they're primarily made of protein. So here's the deal. When you take the dopamine or the carbidopa-levodopa, and it's made of amino acids, and they get down to your stomach, which is where proteins are digested, you literally have to have enough stomach acid to break down the amino acids. Okay? Then you only have certain receptor sites for those amino acids to be absorbed, and they're not absorbed in your stomach, they're actually absorbed in your intestines. But you only have certain receptor sites. And this is what we know, that when you take something that's man-made, and again, I hope you won't be offended by what I'm about to say, versus something that is God-made, it doesn't work the same. And so those man-made amino acids in the levodopa get pushed to the side. And the natural amino acids that are found in food get digested and absorbed very readily. So number one, you may not be getting the full benefit of your medications if you're taking it with your meals. The second thing to consider in that, and we've already talked about constipation being a problem, and the fact that your entire body, and not just your outward body, is affected by that bradykinesia, that slowness of movement. And so if things are moving slowly through your digestive tract, they're not going to get absorbed as well either. So it is very important that you take your carbidopa levodopa 30 minutes to an hour before you eat or 2 hours after you eat. And again, you can say, well, but I don't eat anything protein. People always tell me that. I don't eat anything protein, but I take it with a glass of milk. Duh. So if you absolutely cannot take it on an empty stomach, and some people can't, then take it with something that is less, has less amino acids in it. Remember, amino acids are in everything because they're in every living cell. But take it with something that less, maybe a saltine cracker and some ginger ale, because real ginger ale, be careful what kind of ginger ale you buy, because some of it has very little real ginger in it. But ginger is a natural relaxer. It relaxes your digestive tract. So if you're nauseated, it can help with the nausea. But take it with that or a glass of apple juice. But the less amino acids that you can take with it, the better. Does that make sense?
Water
is the perfect thing to take it with. But most people don't like water. I don't know why, but we don't like water. Okay, another thing that came up was that constipation thing. Question about constipation. It's a huge problem. It's a huge problem for people as we get older anyway. But there are a couple of things that you can do to lessen constipation. And by the way, somebody said, was it my medications? Well, yes, your medications contribute to the constipation. But remember, it's a disease problem too. Because your GI tract, believe me, your GI tract is just a series of muscles that are controlled by nerves. And the nerves are affected by your Parkinson's disease. So then the muscles are affected. So it slows down your GI tract. Consequently, by the way, your medications are not working as effectively. You're going to hear about Duopa in a minute, which is a new way of giving you that carbidopa levodopa. And it's very effective, but there are some drawbacks to that, and he will address those in just a moment. But slow down GI tract, we need to do several things. Number one, make sure you're drinking enough fluids. Every one of us need a minimum of 64 ounces of fluids a day. And I will tell you what Parkinson's patients are notorious for, and I'm fixing to borrow something.
I'll try not to get I washed my hands just a moment ago.
You carry a bottle around like this all day. And I'm not trying to be mean or pick on you, but it's just a fact. You carry a bottle around like this all day, and if I see you at the end of the day, you still have that same bottle, and it's about like this. It's about a fourth gone. And it's just what Parkinson's patients do. And that's not 64 ounces. And by the way, it doesn't have to be water. Some of us don't like water very well. Any fluid. But you have to be careful, because coffee and Cokes and Dr. Peppers have caffeine in them. and caffeine is a natural diuretic. Now, doesn't, if you drink a 32-ounce Coke, pardon my crudeness, but you're not going to pee out 32 ounces. It doesn't work like that, but it does cause you to get rid of fluids more quickly. So you need to be careful about caffeinated drinks. But drink 64 ounces, and I will tell you that I've said this before, and I'm going to say this again. If you are on a fluid-restricted diet, you need to be careful about that. So if you have heart disease and they have you on a restricted diet. But I've said that in front of doctors, and then they've said, no. Your cells still need fluids, and that doctor needs to adjust your medications to help you. Because it's like this. Y'all get ticks up here?
Yeah.
I kind of thought you might. Okay, you ever pulled a tick off of a dog?
Yeah.
And you put it over to the side, and that tick is all big and fat and plumped up, right?
Yeah.
And then you put that over to the side, and don't kill it. I know that doesn't ever happen, but don't kill it. You put it over in a bucket, and you go back a few hours later, and what's happened to that tick? It started to shrivel up. It kind of looks like a raisin now. Because without blood, it shrivels. Well, I got news for you. Without blood, your cells shrivel too. And guess what the main constituent of your blood is? Water. And without water to help with the blood, every single cell in your body will shrivel up just like that. And once it shrivels to a point, just like that tick, if it didn't get back on a dog or a deer, guess what's going to happen to it?
Die.
It's going to die. And if y'all listen real carefully, real quickly, listen. Can you hear it? Right now, some of you can hear, if you'll listen, those brain cells. And they're saying, help, I'm dying, give me some fluid. So that's number one. Number one, make sure you're getting enough fluids. Number two, make sure you're getting enough fiber. Fiber in your diet is crucial. Now, I don't have to say this in Lubbock because we don't have any trees. I'm lying. We really do, but we don't have very many. If you probably have these things on your houses called rain gutters,
yes.
Right? And in the spring of the year, if you don't clean out those gutters and it rains, what happens? It doesn't go down the spout, it goes over the side, right?
Yeah.
It's supposed to go down the spout, but it goes over the side. The same thing happens in your GI tract. If you increase fiber without increasing fluid, it can actually cause a bigger problem and you can get all stopped up. To the point, no joke, to the point that they may have to go in and do a resection to get rid of part of that. So increase fluids, increase fiber, but make sure you do it together. And the most important thing, and you already know the answer to this, you don't know it, who said that? Very good. Exercise. When you exercise any part of your body, it exercises your entire body. If you don't believe me, then someday when you're constipated, I know we're talking about this at lunch, and I'm sorry, but someday when you're constipated, force yourself to go for a long walk or to get on something and really exercise, and you'll be surprised how that bowel movement will just miraculously appear. So, exercise. Matter of fact, I want you to say this word three times. What's the best thing you can do for your Parkinson's overall?
Exercise.
Okay, that was pathetic. That was absolutely pathetic. If you're a Green Bay Packers, I've watched those fools on television. If you're a Green Bay Packers, I know you know how to do this. So ready on the count of three. What's the best thing you can do for your Parkinson's? One, two, three.
Exercise.
Much better. Okay, a couple of other questions that were handed to me, and I promise I'll shut up as quickly as I can. Someone asked and said that their doctor put them on Sinemet for a long period of time, or about 10 months, and they were reluctant to increase the dosage. Sinemet, or the carbidopa levodopa, is the only drug that we have that replaces that dopamine. So it is the creme de la creme, if you will, of treatment for Parkinson's. But carbidopa levodopa, or the levodopa part of that, the Sinemet part of that, has some big side effects. That dyskinesia that we talked about earlier, that's not because of the disease, that's primarily due to the medication. The longer you stay on it, the more side effects it has. A lot of doctors won't even start you on carbidopa levodopa for that very reason. The other thing we know too is when you first get on it, it works great. Matter of fact, sometimes so well that people forget they even have Parkinson's. It's called the honeymoon effect. And that may last for a few months or even a few years with people. But then it stops working as effectively. So then they have to increase the dosage and they have to increase. You may start out 25 over 100 twice a day or three times a day, and then eventually you're taking 50 over 250 and you're taking it six or eight times a day. So the longer you can stay at a very small dose, the better. And I know that your doctor a while ago said that she didn't like the agonist, and that's her personal opinion, and I'm not going to disagree with that. But I will tell you that there are a lot of doctors who start you on agonist or a Azelect or something like that so that you can hold off on taking the Sinemet. It comes from the way she was trained, and every doctor is trained differently. So it's kind of like my nutrition classes. The way I was trained, that's the way that I teach. Another question was, are dopamine replacement drugs able to pass dopamine or levodopa to another person through the exchange of bodily fluids? In all of my years of doing these things, I've never had that question before. So I very quickly got Google out, and I Googled, and I couldn't find anything. So I texted my medical director in Lubbock, and I said, here's the question. She said, I have no clue. But as a general rule, we both will agree, probably not. Now, someone may be confused by that because some of the times there are some of the medications that when someone perspires, you can actually smell the medication coming through their skin. Some of the older drugs are particularly, amantadine is one that you can smell it. When people are on amantadine, I can tell if I'm around you very long because I can smell it. But it doesn't appear, and my big concern was, you know, I never had thought about that. What if you're on chemotherapy, or if you have a compromised immune system, could you be at risk? And apparently, from what we've been able to determine, no. Is there any reason someone using Sinemet would not be allowed to donate blood? No, you can donate blood if you're on Sinemet. I will tell you, though, that if you donate blood, you need to be especially cautious, because when you take out blood, and they don't take out much, but remember what the doctor said a while ago about your blood pressure? Well, that blood is what controls your blood pressure. And so until it gets built back up, you may even be more susceptible to drops in blood pressure, that syncope that we have when we have Parkinson's disease. So I would caution you about that very strenuously. Again, not saying that you can't take it. She mentioned pain, and that was a question that several people have asked. She indicated that there's not a lot of pain with Parkinson's. And I'm not, again, trying to disagree with her, but I will tell you what my medical director, a previous one that's now moved to Oklahoma, his father had Parkinson's disease. He was a movement disorder specialist.
How many of you expected at this point in your life for your spouse to have Parkinson's?
No one.
Most of you were at the time of your life that you were retiring. And you had great plans, didn't you? You were going to go visit the grandkids, or you were going to get in the RV and travel and do all of those fun things. And I'm going to encourage you to keep doing those fun things. You may have to do it in a different way. It may not be as fun as you had planned, but I encourage you to keep doing those. Not only for your spouse that has Parkinson's, but more importantly for you. Here's another one, and this is just a fact. How many of you are retired and with your spouse 24/7? And how many of you found out that when that first happened, with or without Parkinson's, that it wasn't a whole lot of fun? A lot of hands going up, right? Because the reality is, when we get married and we're young and we get married, we usually, for the most part, go our separate ways all day long. And then we come back for a few hours together in the evening. And guess what? Once you retire and once you have Parkinson's, then you're kind of saddled together. And it gets difficult. And all those little things that used to annoy you but you could deal with because you weren't around them all the time, now they've become a humongous big blight on your marriage because you can't ignore them all the time. You're faced with them all the time. And caregivers, I just want to wake you up to the realization of something. As much as those little things that you do that they do frustrate you, chances are all the little things that you've always done that frustrated them just amplified now because you're with each other all the time. Another thing I want to tell you, and I want you to listen very carefully when I say this. I just heard someone say, is that true? Of course it's true. Of course it's true. I don't tell lies. I tell truths up here. I want you to think about this very carefully because we all lose our temper. We all say, how many of you are parents in here? Okay. How many of you, their parents, ever said something to your child in a moment of anger or raised your voice in a moment of anger that you never meant to say or would have and would like to take it all back? And guess what? You're going to do the same thing as a caregiver. But remember this. Once those words roll out of your mouth and they land on someone else's ears, you can take them back. You can apologize. Apologies can be accepted. But guess what? Never forget them. Those are still there. As a matter of fact, I read an article about a school teacher. Maybe even been you, I don't know. But a school teacher who was trying to tell their students, get across to their students, how important that really is, that the words that we say, she was talking about bullying. And I think some of you have paper in front of you, so if you don't want to save your little, I hate for you to tear them up, your little placemat or a piece of paper, grab a piece of paper and wad it up if you have one handy. Wad it up, beat it up, do whatever you want to do with that piece of paper, real quickly. Mutilate it, abuse it, whatever you want to do, and do it quickly. Go ahead. You keep squishing. Now I want you to do something. I want you to try to smooth that out. No, you cannot throw it. You may not throw it at me. No, not paperwork. Well, that's a good idea. Now smooth that out and get it just as smooth as you can. You know what? She said, can I borrow a steam iron? But you know what? Even if you use a steam iron on it, guess what? See those scars? They're still there. Those scars are still there. You can't get rid of them. And remember that the next time you start to lose your temper, you snap, and we're all going to do it. It's human. We all do it. But remember that you cannot take those things back. And by the way, that since we have a lot of patients in here, that goes for you as well. You lose your temper. You get frustrated. This is a frustrating disease. One of the things that patients tell me all the time is, I get so frustrated because I can't do the things that I used to do. I can't do them like I want to do. And I'll just tell you that it's difficult for the patient, male or female. And here's the reality of it. Oftentimes, roles have to change. Maybe you've always been the male, the head of the household, and you've always taken on the role of protecting the family, maybe taking care of the finances. And guess what? You may not be able to do that. And that's very frustrating. As a matter of fact, I've heard men say, I feel like I have been robbed of my manliness. Now that's pretty powerful, to think that you've been robbed of your manliness because of your Parkinson's diagnosis. Because you can't necessarily protect your family anymore, not like you could. You can't necessarily do the bookkeeping anymore, pay the bills. But be man enough or woman enough, as the case may be, to accept that I can't, and to graciously turn that over to your spouse. By the same token, I have women who feel very, very frustrated because they no longer can do the things that they once did. They can't cook the meals like they once did, and their spouse is having to take over that role. Or they can't care for the grandchildren like they once could. And that's very frustrating from their standpoint as well. So keep that in mind. Roles are changing. And sometimes it's difficult to admit that and to give up those things that we've been used to doing, whichever way it's going. And again, with or without Parkinson's, as we get older, we may have to give up some of those things. Driving. My mother finally had to quit driving a couple of years ago. She actually didn't have to. She chose to. And it's killed her ever since. She's 92 and she still lives by herself. But it kills her that she no longer drives because she said, I gave up my life when I gave up my car keys. Because now she is totally dependent on someone else. But I will caution you, as those of you who have Parkinson's, that is a very important conclusion that you come to on your own, that it's time to give up the keys. And it may not be as important out here where you're kind of rural, but in a city, and believe it or not, Lubbock is a city. We're over 250,000 now, so we're a small city. But it's very important there, and I suspect it's equally as important here. And I'm just going to put this really harsh, horrible thought in your mind. The absolute last thing that you want to do is cause harm to someone else. And we know that one of the problems with your Parkinson's is that your reactions are slower. You saw it when she spun around and turned. You even saw it this morning when she started to take that first step and she couldn't, right? That hesitation. And that happens when we drive. And by the way, another problem that all Parkinson's patients have is you have a perception problem. If I ask you as a Parkinson's patient, are you still swinging your arms and taking big steps? 90% of the time you're going to tell me yes. To the point that when we've had people in therapy, they actually do not believe when we show them a videotape of themselves, like before they start the big program, and then at the conclusion of it, some of them swear up and down that that is not even them in the photograph. I had a man that absolutely got mad and argued with me. And I said, look very carefully. You have on the same jacket, the same tie, and the same pair of slacks today. And he went, oh my goodness, I guess that was me. But he didn't even recognize himself. A lot of times when speech therapists are doing speech with our Parkinson's patients, the patients will swear up and down that they're talking loudly. In reality, they're talking like this. And the speech therapist will have to tape them and play it back over and over to prove. So you have a perception problem. Just accept that. It's a part of your Parkinson's disease. Your perception of yourself and your symptoms has been skewed. And that causes a problem, especially when it comes to those car keys. And here's another reality for both of you to realize. Parkinson's patients have a hard time staying in their lane. Had a couple out in Las Cruces several years ago, and he and his wife both worked in Las Cruces, but they lived out in the desert. And every day they would meet at about the same point as they got off work. And he said, I noticed that when my wife was in town and in the three or four lanes of traffic, that she could stay in her lane. But as soon as we hit the open road out toward the house, she drove from side to side. There was a young man, has a young onset Parkinson's patient whose daughter started to Baylor down in Waco. And they lived out in Clovis, New Mexico. That's a long drive, by the way, about an 8-hour drive. And he would get close to Baylor or close to Waco, and he got pulled over by the highway patrolman every single time. Now, this may not mean anything to you all, because I know your religious preferences are a little bit different than what we have. He was a Bible-thumping Baptist. You know what that means?
Yes.
He wouldn't touch a drop of alcohol for anything. And he got picked up every single time because they thought he was intoxicated. Because of the way he swerved on the road. They finally got where they recognized him, and they pull him over and visit with him for a few minutes. But every single time, again, he swore up and down he was going straight down that highway. But his perception was skewed. And here's the problem. If he had hit somebody, if a child had run out in front of him, right here, I heard the band playing when we were outside a while ago. The high school's not far from here. We passed an elementary school. Just think about it. Don't make someone give up your car keys or take away your car keys because you've hurt someone. Be willing to give those up. And that wasn't part of my caregiver thing. I apologize for that. But anyway, I'm going to encourage you both as caregivers and as patients to go home and do this. That's why I made this. So you can take it home with you and spend some time thinking about it. What you worry about. Notice up here it says, Webster defines fear as a deep and overwhelming or reverential awe or dread. Bishop Fulton, who quite frankly, until I did this, had no clue who Bishop Fulton was. Bishop Fulton Sheen. I had to go home and look him up. But he once said, the catalog of fears is the catalog of loves. Love is an attraction for an object. Fear is flight away from it. But here's the problem. When you worry about something, it turns into a fear or a dread. There's no point in worrying. Again, I hope I'm in a place where I can say this. The Bible is very clear. It says worry doesn't change a thing. Have you noticed that?
Yes.
No matter how much you worry, it doesn't fix the problem at all. So you have to do something more objective about it. And I would suggest that one of the things that you can do is fill this out. If you don't really know what you're worried about, you can't change it. So I would go through and ask yourself, have you ever had the fear of failure? Or has that ever kept you from doing something? I hear this from caregivers all the time, just exactly what you said. I am afraid that I'm not going to be able to take care of him, or maybe to do it in the right way. And that's a common problem. And I will tell you this, as caregivers, you need to keep this in mind. There is probably no one that can take care of your spouse better than you can. So quit second guessing yourself. Give yourself a pat on the back because you're a good caregiver. I can almost guarantee it. No one loves your spouse like you do. So no one is going to be able to care for them like you do. Now, are you going to get frustrated? Are you going to make mistakes? Yes. And this is something else I always want you to think about. Those of you who are caregivers, I want you to do something for me, a little crazy, but I want you to do something for me real quickly. I want you to pull your shirt out, and I want you to look down your chest, and I want you to see if you see anything there. I mean, I see a couple of things down there, but I want you to take a look, and I want you to see if anything is right there. Because chances are none of you have a big old S emblazoned there for superhero or superwoman or Superman, right?
Right.
So you're going to make mistakes as caregivers. You're not going to do it all right. And I go back to my reference to you as parents. How many of you were a perfect parent? Did you make mistakes? You're darn tootin', you're right, there's no such thing. Matter of fact, I was always brought up that there was only one perfect person, and we kind of messed that up ourselves and kind of hung him on a tree or something like that. So pretty sure none of you are perfect, so remember that. And every time you start feeling a little bit overwhelmed, I want you to do that. I want you to pull your shirt out and take a look and see if that S has started to appear. Because if it hasn't, then you realize that you're going to make mistakes, and that's okay. You have every right to make mistakes. I hope that you'll do these, by the way, not just by yourself, but that you'll take time to do them. I would actually suggest that you do this. I would suggest that you fill this out by yourself, and then your spouse fill them out so that you can be totally honest. And then get together and talk about them. Because that's the other thing. In order to be a successful caregiver, you have to keep the lines of communication open. And that's real hard with Parkinson's patients. Because as we've already said, Parkinson's patients tend to withdraw. And by the way, one of the reasons they do that is because we didn't have time to go over all this earlier. But one of the first things that happens cognitively with Parkinson's patients, and by the way, let me reassure you, if you have Parkinson's, you're as smart as you've ever been. And you're not going to get any dumber. But you may have a difficult time sometimes recalling things. Word finding is one of the most common problems with Parkinson's patients. You know what you want to say. You can even see it written on the back of your eyeball somewhere back there. But getting it from here out of your mouth is very, very difficult. And oftentimes spouses don't help. Because when they see you struggling, instead of just kind of giving you a little cue to keep you talking, they just take over the conversation. And caregivers are notorious for that. And so, guess what happens to that patient?
They withdraw.
And there's more to it than that. It's actually more complicated. I did an article in the newsletter a couple of years ago, and I discovered that there's a whole new type of psychological issue that Parkinson's patients have, where that's part of it. You withdraw. Literally, and that's part of the psychological part. Some people have always been very dynamic, and they were people lovers. And all of a sudden, they're diagnosed with Parkinson's, and they have a hard time being around people. And I used to think, well, it's just because they're embarrassed, because someone told me a while ago they drool. And by the way, if you're a drooler, you're not producing more saliva. Here's the problem. Remember that bradykinesia where you don't do things as quickly? You're not closing your mouth. That's as simple as it is. You sit there with your mouth just slightly ajar, and I mean just slightly, but here's the problem with that. When your mouth is just slightly ajar, it is virtually impossible for you to swallow. Your mouth has to be shut for you to swallow. So saliva, which by the way, we are always, constantly, we produce about a water bottle full of saliva every day in our mouth under normal circumstances. And the problem is, if you're not closing your mouth, then it starts to trickle out. And that's why. Now, every once in a while, there is a Parkinson's patient that actually does produce more saliva. But 99% of the time, it's because you're not closing your mouth. So as he said, when I mentioned that to him, you know, my wife tells me all the time to shut my mouth. Well, she might have a point, at least in this one instance. You might need to shut your mouth. Not really, but sort of. So keep that in mind, okay? As you fill this out, be completely honest with yourself. If you don't want to share your answers with your spouse, you don't have to. But you need to come to an understanding of what you really feel and what your fears really are if you even have a remote chance of changing anything. So be honest. No one's going to see it but you unless you choose to share it. So be honest. Winston Churchill, he's a pretty cool guy, and he once said, "Let your advanced worrying become advanced thinking and planning." Doesn't that sound like something Winston Churchill would have said?
Sure.
But guess what? There's a lot of reality to that. If you plan ahead, if you know what's coming, then you can plan for those problems to occur. So keep that in mind. Remember, as I said a while ago, chances are that no one knows your loved one better than you do. And so no one is going to do as good a job as you do at caring for them, even if you make mistakes. And as I said, we all will. I've got to hurry real quickly because we're running out of time. So let me very quickly turn to the next to the last page, I believe it is, and it says, identifying and preventing caregiver burnout. And I had a stress test, or burnout test, I was going to pass out to you, and I decided not to do that. So we're just going to do it this way. Stage one of caregiver burnout, frustration. It's okay. You feel frustrated. But if it becomes more than just frustration, it may lead to depression. And that becomes a cause for concern. Because we can't have both of you depressed. They can't help it. They're depressed because of their disease. We don't need you depressed. And by the way, about 90% of caregivers at some point or another go on antidepressants. And that's okay too. And I'm just going to tell you, I'm not a big person that pushes pill popping, but I will tell you, we had a psychiatrist from Dallas, from UT Southwestern, speak at our conference last year. And he said, they have proven now that when people get depressed, it literally changes the anatomy of the brain. That those chemicals, it's kind of like, I don't know if y'all farm around here or not, but if you know where farmers, they have a furrow, right? They plow their field. And after you do that a few times, then those are permanent, unless you have West Texas winds, but they become permanent. And so that's what happens in the brain. When you get depressed, it literally makes these furrows because of the chemicals, the path that they take. And after you stay that way for a long time, and he showed us in scans, it literally changes the dynamic, the structure of the brain. And so you have to apply another chemical to change it back the way it's supposed to be. So don't be afraid. Don't be ashamed. I know that's kind of this, especially this age group that you all are in. I know it is in West Texas, but I suspect it is here too. Oh, my George, I'm not depressed. I'm just going to pull myself up by my bootstraps and go on, right? My mother always says, well, that's in your brain. Well, yeah, it is, Mom. Depression is in your brain. But that doesn't mean that you can just get over it. As a matter of fact, whether you have Parkinson's or not, think about it this way. How ludicrous would it be for you to say, oh, yeah, I have Parkinson's, but by George, I'm just going to get over it all by myself. I'm not going to take that silly old medicine. For my tremor, I'm just going to say, hand, stop shaking. Is that the way it works?
No.
Not usually. And by the same token, you can't just say, mind, quit being depressed. It's not going to work that way. I wish it did. I wish it did, but it's not. And so at least for a period of time, even caregivers may need to be on an antidepressant. By the way, that depression, that frustration builds, and it can lead to grief and anxiety, and that's when it really becomes a problem with depression. Finally, stage three is despair. The final stage of caregiver burnout is despair. The feelings of complete helplessness and hopelessness. And like I said, I've seen some caregivers that over a period of time have completely changed their personalities. I went to a funeral a few years ago. This gentleman had Parkinson's. He was a Methodist minister. I worked with him for probably 15 years. Loved him. But I always thought she was the meanest woman that I had ever met in my life. I'm not joking. I really didn't care for her at all. Loved him. Did not really care for her. He actually passed away first, and a few months later, she passed away. And by the way, neither of them because of their Parkinson's, but passed away. And at the funeral, all of these people came up and started talking to her. It was one of those where, you know, the preacher said a little bit, and then everybody walked up there and stood and talked. And they talked about what a wonderful woman she was, and how sweet she was, and how kind she was, and all of these wonderful things that she had done all through the years. And I thought, they've got to be mistaken. That was the meanest, witchiest woman I had ever met in my life. And then it dawned on me. She'd been living with this person that had Parkinson's for 30 years. With his Parkinson's. She was burned out. Long time. Probably about the time I met her, apparently, from what I heard. She had reached that point, and she had become an awful old lady. And I really felt guilty about it. I felt like, you know, I feel bad that I never knew her for who she really was. All I saw was the shell of a person that she had become. So don't let that happen to you as a caregiver. Don't let the anger, the frustration, the depression get you to the point that people don't even recognize you for who you are anymore. That's not good. Notice, if you're suffering from anxiety, anger, alienation, irritability, impatience, lack of compassion, lack of control, lack of caring, hopelessness, sensitivity to criticism, that's when someone says something to you and you take it real personally, when you probably shouldn't. Loss of hope, loss of joy, loss of humor, loss of meaning, withdrawal. And by the way, this happens to all of us. My mom fell last year, broke her pelvis and her lower back, and then while she was recuperating in the rehab hospital, they caused her to break her elbow, and so she had to go back to the hospital, have surgery, and come back out. And I am not the only child that lives in the town where we do, but for some reason, and I'm not just saying this, it's a fact, I'm the one that takes care of my mother the most. And I was always helping her, and then when she got out of the hospital, I was taking care of her all the time and going by her house, and I work about 80 hours a week, no exaggeration. And then I was taking care of her, and then I was ready to have this new grandbaby, and one day, Mother made this comment, and I shouldn't even share this with you, but I'm just telling you, we're all susceptible to this. I had reached my point and didn't even realize it. And she made some comment about she couldn't go to church because she didn't have anything to wear. And so I went out and took time off from work one day and went out and bought her some new clothes and took them to the house. And she said, well, why did you buy those? I didn't need those new clothes. And yada, 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 and she's not normally not a nice person. She's one of the sweetest, most unconfrontational people that you'll ever meet. But she was, like, confronting me, and I said, because that's what you said. And she said, I never said that. And I was like, Mother, you did too. And I got real angry, and I cried, and I said, well, I'll just take them all back then. And then I walked out of the house and slammed the door, and I felt like such an idiot. And I hurt my mother, and I felt guilty. And I'm just telling you this. I'm sharing this very personal thing with you because I don't like for people to see that I'm human. I'm supposed to be ultra-human or something. But it happens to all of us. Yes, ma'am?
Do you have an ass?
I'm sorry?
Do you have an ass?
Well, I keep checking, smarty pants. I think I did, but I think it kind of fell off that day. My ass fell off that day. No, I don't have an ass. I shouldn't even repeat this. What I actually thought you said was, do I have an ass? It did sound like it, didn't it? And I thought, well, that's an odd question to ask. That's what I thought, too. So, no, I do have one of those, although that's not the part that sticks out the most around here. But no, I don't have an ass either. I did buy some. I have a patient whose husband has Parkinson's, and she actually had a double mastectomy, and she kind of feels like she has an ass on her. So I found some Superman Band-Aids that just have big S's on them. So I took them to her recently to put on her little mastectomy wounds, and she, I'm not sure she appreciated my humor, but anyway, I thought it was kind of funny. Anyway, okay, team building with Parkinson's, and this is for both of you, all of you. If you have Parkinson's, be honest with each other about your fears and concerns, because chances are if you're fearing not being able to take care of him, he may be worried that you're not going to be able to take care of him too. So those fears are usually the same. Listen to the fears that you, listen to each other, basically. Be good communicators. And by the way, I don't know if you've noticed this, but when we fight and argue with our spouses, we don't usually fight fairly. Matter of fact, if you've ever noticed, it's not the big things that we fight over. I've been divorced. I was married 10 years, and I've been divorced forever. And I look back at my marriage, and I think, you know, we rarely ever fought, if you want to know the truth. He was a doctor, and he met a nurse, and you know the story. But anyway, the truth of the matter is, we never fight about the, it is. We never fight, his favorite movie was Dr. Zhivago, too. Our daughter's even named.
That's our favorite.
Yeah, well, if you're a doctor, it has a whole different meaning to it. But anyway, our daughter is named Laura, L-A-R-A, too. Does that tell you anything? And he was having an affair during that whole process. But anyway, that's beside it. Here's the reality of it. We never fight about the big things. Because what we do, we called it in counseling, we called it gunny sacking. Now, I know y'all didn't pick cotton around here, but do you know what a gunny sack is?
Yeah.
Good, because I didn't have a clue when I heard that term the first time. Oh, you did potatoes? Okay. So we all these little frustrations, we pile in this sack. We gunny sack them, right? And then all of a sudden, someday, they do some little bitty tiny thing that has nothing to do with anything that we're really mad about. You're right. And that gunny sack just explodes. And all the things, it had nothing to do about what this argument's about, but all of the things from the past months or years comes out. Well, you blah, 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 and that's not fair. So number one, learn to fight fairly. This goes for patients and caregivers, because both of us gunny sack all the time. So fight fairly and be honest about it. If you're upset about something, don't wait until it becomes, the mountain out of the molehill thing?
Yeah.
Don't wait until it becomes a mountain. Take care of it when it's still a molehill. And we do that by keeping the lines of communication open. When we can talk to each other. And if you love each other, you should be able to talk to each other about the small things. Now, if you're a caregiver, and he says something or she says something to you, and it frustrates you, that criticism, remember, that's a symptom that you're reaching a point in your caregiving that you shouldn't reach. So if you're ultra-sensitive to someone's criticism, keep that in mind and be cognizant of that. Make your relationships about more than the disease. Don't let it become the elephant in the room. If you have things that you wanted to do, if you wanted to travel to the East Coast and go up and down the colonies and visit all of those battlegrounds, then go do it. You may have to do it slower. You may have to do it with a wheelchair, but you can still do the things that you enjoy. If you have a hobby, continue as a caregiver and as a patient, by the way, to do that hobby. Now, you may be one of my board members who is a Parkinson's patient in Lubbock. He was a woodworker for years. And sadly, a couple of years ago, he almost cut his thumb off. And so we said, okay, Emmett, you can't do that anymore. You're going to have to find a new hobby. Because it has become dangerous for you. But there's still tons of hobbies that you can do. We all need a hobby. And that doesn't count sitting in front of the television at night watching The Process Right or Jeopardy. By the way, that's not good brain exercise either. That doesn't count as exercise unless you stand behind the recliner and march in place or do exercise while you watch those shows. That's the only way that it counts. Don't be afraid to ask for help as a patient or a caregiver. Let me ask you this. How many of you, and be honest, how many of you, if you knew that a friend or a someone put it one time, because I'm the world's worst at asking for help, and I'm admitting that, or accepting help from anyone, and if someone put it one time to me, you are robbing me of a blessing that God may have very well put me on the earth to do if you're not allowing me to help you. It's still hard for me to accept, but every once in a while, that echoes in my head, and I very willingly let someone do something for me. So don't rob someone else of someone's blessing or of a blessing that, as I said, God may have put them on the earth to help at that very thing. And I apologize for being so religious today. I hope that's not offensive to anyone. I don't know about here, but oftentimes people still live at home, and maybe you can't go get your, or maybe you're living at home with your spouse that doesn't have Parkinson's, but you just don't have time, or maybe there's snow. I don't know if y'all have that much snow, but maybe there's snow or ice on the ground. Yeah, I kind of suspected. Maybe there's snow or ice on the ground, and it's not safe for you to get out. Remember what we said about those broken hips. Whether you have Parkinson's or not, you're susceptible to that. And by the way, if you break a hip, where does that leave your patient? So maybe that's when, instead of risking your life and your body to go out and buy groceries, maybe you pick up the phone and call someone to do it. I know a lot of the grocery stores and things in our area actually have delivery systems for our elderly people and people who are difficult. Okay, real quickly, I can't go through all of this. Someone asked me about freezing, where you can't move with your Parkinson's. So let me give you some helpful hints real quickly, and I did put them on here because these are things that frustrate Parkinson's patients. When you freeze, it literally is like your brain is stuck in place. As an example, how many of you remember the old records that we used to have?
Yeah.
I'm even young enough to remember, or old enough to remember those. And remember when that record would get a scratch in it?
Yeah.
And it would go, da-da, da-da, because it couldn't move out of that scratch. And so you had to do what? You had to go over and physically lift it out to the next little spot, right? That's exactly, sort of, what happens when you're freezing. Your brain is stuck in a rut, and you can't get out of it. Excuse me, until you do something different. Sometimes all it is, I'm going to use you because you're close. Sometimes all I have to do is someone standing frozen in place is just touch them. And just that distracts their brain and puts it onto something else, and so they can now move. Sometimes you may have walked through that door 50 times, and on the 51st time, it's like you have cement boots. You cannot move through that doorway. Doorways, thresholds, those sort of things are difficult oftentimes. Doctors can't explain exactly why it is, but it's a reality. And so again, distracting, maybe putting your hand on them, having them quit focusing on what they're doing and look at you. People get frozen when they walk, and here's an easy one. You can count, or, and I caution people about doing that because I had a patient that I said, okay, count. Well, he was a career military, retired, a career military man. They called me one day out of clinic, and they said, Joe, you need to come out here. We don't know what's wrong with Mr. So-and-so. And he was standing, he started out of the clinic, and he got frozen, and so he started counting, but he was going, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, and I'm going to tie myself up in a knot if I keep doing that. Don't count like you're marching. Pick a spot on the horizon, a spot on the door or on the hall, and say, I bet it'll take me about 15 steps to get there. And play a little game. You can play it with your spouse. We have a lot of people that walk in our mall, and they will play a game with each other. I bet it'll take us 35 steps to get down to that next door. And they keep doing that. They keep setting another goal to keep you from freezing. So if you freeze, pick a spot and count. Think to yourself, 15 steps. I bet I can get there in 15 steps. It doesn't matter if you're right or if you're wrong, because guess what? You've moved the needle. You've taken the needle out of the place, and you've moved it. Sometimes people get stuck, frozen, if you will, saying a particular word. They're trying to say something, and so it comes across like this. Right? Have you ever heard a Parkinson's patient do that? Again, take them out of that, distract them by reversing their attention. Get them to think about something else. And by the way, if you have that problem, you're trying to think of a word and you can't think about it, it's just like trying to find your car keys. The harder you try, the less successful you're going to be, right? So go on to something else, and then it'll pop in your little head, the words you were trying to say. Now, as a spouse, you can help them out. Don't take over the conversation, but give them, you know what they're trying to say. Give them that one word, or maybe two words, to get them going again. But again, don't take over the conversation. I know I've gone over, and I know you're going to shoot me if you can even get back up here again. Let me ask you this. Are there any questions that I have not answered that someone... Yes, ma'am.
Is it hereditary? Is Parkinson's hereditary?
Is Parkinson's hereditary? It can be, but in less than 10% of the cases, is it actually, and that was the question I had this morning, is it actually inherited in less than 10% of cases? Any other questions? Yes, ma'am.
Do you know if
has any Parkinson's been helped by using marijuana? There are some studies that may suggest, but it's not smoking it, it's not eating it in brownies, it's the oil. But I will tell you that what it helps with Parkinson's is the pain that people may or may not have. And here's my problem with taking the marijuana or smoking marijuana.
Evaluation.
If any of you have ever known anyone that did marijuana, it chills them out, right? It slows them down. Now let me ask you, if you have Parkinson's, do you need any help being slowed down and chilled down? So that's my concern. Now, the oil doesn't seem to have that effect, but it very well may. So the research is still inconclusive about the benefits for Parkinson's. Yes, sir? Okay, and he said coffee appears to help Parkinson's. And I will give you with that a lot of people say drinking a cup of coffee helps. That's why, you think. Because coffee is a stimulant. And so it has, you know, you're all chilled out with your Parkinson's, so it has the opposite effect. Now, here's a caution though. If you have a tremor, that stimulant is going to make that tremor worse. And I will tell you, I feel sorry for you all, because the other thing that makes the tremor worse is the cold. Because naturally, when we're cold, what do? We shiver. And if you start shivering and you have a tremor, it's going to get a lot worse. So, yes, ma'am. Okay, she said her husband has a visual problem with Parkinson's disease. A lot of times Parkinson's patients have a tremor in their eyes. And so there is a thing, it's not always successful, but they can put a prism in your glasses. And I know this may make sense to you. I've had eye doctors. I've had eye doctors explain it to me, and to be real honest, it still doesn't make any sense. But a prism is refracted light. And somehow when you have refracted light and you have a tremor, that refracted light brings it all together. So it takes away the double vision that a lot of the Parkinson's patients have. It is, but they can put the prisms. They can put the prisms in the glasses. And you may have to go to Lansing or some big city to have that done to see it. And there are what they call neuro-ophthalmologists that specialize in diseases like this. So you might talk to them. Yes, ma'am?
You said there's a increased risk for aspirating if the voice is softened.
Okay, there is a therapy program called LSVT Loud. That literally stands for Lee Silverman Voice Training. And it was designed by a Parkinson's patient family member who was a speech therapist. It's been around for years and years and years. And what it does is it retrains the brain. Several years after that had been in existence, she and this physical therapist that were good friends were talking one day, and she said, you know, I think that we could do the same things that you do with loud and do it physically. And so they created LSVT Big. And what both of those literally do is they retrain the brain. Remember I told you your perception is skewed? They retrain you. You do big movements. You do loud voices. You over-exaggerate, or what it feels like to the Parkinson's patient, is you're way off over the top. In reality, you're normal. So it literally retrains the brain. And both of them are extremely effective. They're both, if they're done properly, it's an hour a day for 4 days for 4 weeks. 4 days a week for 4 weeks. Okay, and in order for it to work properly, because again, they're retraining the brain, that's the way it's most effective. But here's the deal. If you go through the physical therapy, or if you go through LSVT Big or Loud, and then you don't do the exercises that they have you do, not just then, but henceforth and forevermore, then you're going to end up just like you were when you started. So it's not a one-time thing. It's a continuous lifetime thing. You have to be committed to it for it to work. But it will work. It works very effectively. Both of them do. I'm out. If you want to talk, ask any more questions and find me at the back, because she's going to shoot me.
I have one announcement. Somebody lost a pumpkin pendant, an ant pin or something like that. If you find it, please give it to one of us who are working here, and we'll see that person gets it back. Joe has a ton of handouts. Please help yourself. Go see the vendors. Take something home with you, because we don't want to take it home. Thank you loads for coming. I appreciate all of you. Let's have another one another time. I would like to have your evaluations. Or give them to one of us. We appreciate that very much. Thank you. Have a safe drive home.